Dear Heavenly Father, we praise you, Lord God. We praise you, Lord God. We praise you, Jesus. We praise you, Jesus. We thank you, Father. Glory to you, Father God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We praise you, Father, for every drink of water. We praise you, Father, for every bite of food. We thank you, Father God, for every night that we sleep with a roof over our heads. We thank you, Father God, for every week that we have a job. We know that you are in control of all of our lives, all of our situations, Father God, and we just praise you for that. Father, we just lift you up and glorify your holy name, and we thank you, Jesus. We praise you, Jesus. Jesus, we love you for the things that you have done for us. We love you for the love that you gave us before the foundations of the earth. We praise you for this opportunity, this electronic ecclesia, to be able to get together, to gather together, and to discuss exciting things about the heavens, exciting things about the things that are happening across the earth right now, even the biblical prophecies that are unfolding across the world, how the Bible is reading like a newspaper. Father, we just praise you for that. We thank you for your judgments. We thank you for the opportunity that you have laid before us to be able to bring people into the kingdom through the hardships that occur on this earth. So many of these opportunities would not be available to so many people, Father God, if it wasn't for the darkness that is affecting people's lives. We praise you for these opportunities. We thank you for our options, Father God, that you have laid before us within the realm of our influence to be able to touch people's lives, to be able to discuss things with people at work. Help us, Father God, place a burden upon our spirits, Father, to be ye doers of the word, not just hearers of the word, deceiving ourselves, James 1:22. Help us to see the opportunity, the divine commission, whereby we have been called to go out and preach the gospel to people, to lay hands on people, to cleanse the lepers, Father God, to cast out the demons, the darkness, Mark 16:16-18. We praise you for that. Help us to have the strength, Father, to be who you have wanted us to be, from since the beginning of the earth, Father God. We praise you for the commission that you have laid before us. We know that you were the one who chose us. It was not us who chose you. And we praise you for that. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Father God, we pray in the name of Jesus that you will empty all of our cups tonight and just fill us all with your Holy Spirit. Give us, Father, throughout the darkness, throughout the difficult times that we're struggling with, many of us, Father, as we're walking through our daily lives, as we're dealing with the things that we have to deal with, Father, in our jobs, in our home lives, with our families, with the rejection that many of us have to deal with. Father, we just praise you for that. We lift up and we thank you, Jesus, for Luke 6, verse 22. For blessed are you when men hate you, and when they exclude you, and when they revile you, and cast out your name as evil for the Son of Man's sake. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for indeed your reward is great in heaven. We stand upon that scripture. We hold it up before you, Father, and we give you praise for it. We give you praise for it. So many of us, Father, have lost our families, have turned against us, our spouses in some cases, Father, different parts of our families, friends, we've had to have been turned away from us, Father, and we know this is part of walking in holiness. We know that this is a big part of the change that we're supposed to go through, and we ask you, Father, for that Philippians 4:6-8, for supernatural peace, which passes all understanding, to come upon our hearts and our minds through the power of Christ Jesus in us. For we are crucified in Christ, and it is no longer us who lives, but Christ, our Jesus, who lives in us. Praise you, Lord. Thank you, Father. We just praise you for that. Any of us, Father God, I lift up every single listener of this show tonight. I pray in the name of Jesus, Father God, from your eternal realm, that you will see us united in spirit and in truth, whether we are listening live, whether we are listening in a recorded podcast, Father. I pray in the name of Jesus, you will hear our prayers tonight, united in spirit and in truth, in corporate prayer across this world, where two or three are gathered together, there you are amidst us. Father, we stand upon that promise. In Jesus' name, we lift up our fellow brothers and sisters that are dealing with addictions, that are dealing with the forces of darkness, that are dealing with the buffeting of demons in their lives, that are getting undue persecution from those around them, whether it be family or people at work. Father, we hold them up, and together, united in spirit and in truth, with our holy hands raised before you, Father, we come against the demons of death. We rebuke the devil, and he must flee from us. We command the demons to get out. We command the indwelling demons to get out of our lives, to get out of our loved ones, to get out of the people that we work with in Jesus' name, and we take authority over them, and we cast them out. Never come back in Jesus' mighty name, we command it. Hallelujah. Father, we declare a holy fire, a Zechariah 2:5 holy fire to surround us, to protect us. We stand upon the promises of Psalms 91:11. Father, send your angels to take charge over us, to surround our households, to surround our cars, to surround our families and our children, to surround all of our loved ones, Father, to protect our interests, Father, that we may be able to serve you. We praise you, Father, for every element of our lives, every attribute, everything that you have commissioned before us, Father, that you have laid before us as a blessing. We praise you for it, and we ask you, Father, to protect us from the forces of darkness, to protect our jobs as the days get darker. For the king's heart is in the hands of the Lord. Like the rivers of water, you turn them wherever you wish. And we stand upon that promise. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. We praise you for that, Father God. We know the thoughts that you think about us, not thoughts of evil, but thoughts of good to bring us to an expected end. And we praise you for that. We trust in the Lord with all of our heart. We lean not upon our own understanding. In all ways, Father God, we acknowledge you and we praise your holy name. And we believe that you will direct our path. In Jesus' mighty name. And now to him who is able to keep us from stumbling, Lord Jesus, and present us faultless before the presence of your glory, Father God, with exceeding joy. And to you, Father, our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forever. Amen. Praise Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Father, we just praise you. We praise you. We praise you. We praise you. We thank you for choosing us before the foundations of the earth. We are not from here, and we are not staying here. We are sojourners. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. This is awesome. Somebody sent me this in just today, I think. Today or yesterday. I can't remember. All the days just blur together. You know how it is. Praise God. Listen to this. This is awesome. It's by Edward A. Guest. Praise Jesus. I'd rather see a sermon than hear one any day. I'd rather one should walk with me than merely show the way. The eye is a better pupil and more willing than the ear. Fine counsel is confusing, but examples always clear. And the best of all the preachers are the men who live their creeds. For to see the good in action is what everybody needs. I can soon learn how to do it if you'll let me see it done. I can watch your hands in action, but your tongue too fast may run. And the lectures you deliver may be very wise and true, but I'd rather get my lesson by observing what you do. For I may understand you and the high advice you give, but there's no misunderstanding how you act and how you live. Praise Jesus. Hallelujah. That's powerful. That's powerful. That's what I call applied Christianity 101. Amen, Kenneth?
Oh, yeah. You know, it's like you said, it's not in our words, it's in our deeds. And, you know, when you hear stuff like that, when you realize that this isn't just a platitude, these things we speak about, these aren't just nice things to clip and put on your refrigerator with a magnet beside your grandson's picture or your daughter's report card. These are lessons in life. When applied, you'll start to see a life of abundance and a life of power in Christ Jesus. So, yeah, amen, brother. It's something we have to take and put into action, you know. And until we do that, it's really nothing more than a platitude or a nice saying, you know. And I just think it's something we have to do. You have to grasp it, folks, and then you have to start living it.
Yeah, amen. And you know the first thing that typically pops into at least my head and probably other people's heads is, you know, how we feel that there's been so many bad examples of Christian life living out there in front of us, especially because isn't it just unfortunate that so many Christian leaders or whatever over the years have, you know, if they make a mistake or there's one that's really found to be, you know, part of the darkness and is exposed, why, you can believe with all your heart that that particular person is going to be headlines on every single newscast all across the entire world. The devil's going to exploit it to absolute maximum capacity. And but you know what? You have a whole bunch of really good ones out there, you know, at least ones that are trying their best, you know, with what they know. I don't think there's so few good nowadays. I mean, folks, come on, we're at the very end. I mean, you know, this is the end, you know, but you know, so my point being that they're, you know, really, when you look at the aggregate sum total, mathematically speaking, there really aren't an awful lot of good churches out there. And when I say church, I'm being a little, I don't know what the right word is. I'm being very biblical in this sense and in an admonishing sort of way. I'm not saying that the church that you're going to isn't a good church. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is if they're not preaching righteousness and holiness, by the way, which is one of the things that is a dead giveaway for me to the authenticity of Kat Kerr's ministry. Now I'm here to tell you, folks, and I'm very excited that we have him coming back on. Praise God. We have Brother LV Zapata joining us in a couple more weeks. We need to get our heads out of the darkness, you know, amen, a little bit, and we need to focus on the rewards. We need to focus on the goodness of heaven. We need to understand what it is that we are willing to lay down our lives for, other than just the love of Jesus, as if that wasn't enough, which it is. But throughout the entire Bible, we have all of this information that talks about heaven, and it's so glorious, but it's very difficult to read it and get our hearts and our minds around it. And so God has given us a tremendous gift with so many people that have been taken to heaven and hell to give us a more crystal clear understanding. As a matter of fact, there's a website out there. Now, I don't have it handy. I kind of feel bad that at this moment that I didn't dig it up for people to go out and research it. Sister Cathy, I don't know if you have a copy of this web or a link to this website, or even if the website's still out there. I'm not talking about spiritlessons.com. That's not the one. I'm talking about there was another website out there that did a wonderful job of comparing in a godly way, a whole bunch. I mean, my goodness, there must have been 12, maybe two dozen even, people that over the years had been taken to heaven and such, that had, what this particular website had done was they had done an analysis, and they looked at all of the testimonies of these people and said, holy cow, this is unheard of. They were really quite amazed at how much the percentage of the testimonies that matched. And it was very well done. Praise Jesus. I wish I had it. I know I have it somewhere, but I don't have it handy for the show. Yeah, and Sister Cathy is saying it's divinerevelations.info. And that may be it. Let me see if this is, well, that one there is also Spirit Lessons. Anyway, praise God. I'm not going to dwell on it. The point is that there are some wonderful works out there, if you do some digging, where some very godly people have made some comparisons side by side and actually built tables. Excel spreadsheet type tables, you know, of, you know, how did they describe the streets? How did they describe the buildings? How did they describe the mansions? Were there mansions in the country and mansions in the city? Was there an outer environment area that had periods of time that were darker, you know, kind of shady area as compared to the 24/7 light area that's in the city of God? You know, how did they describe the city of God? How did they describe the throne room of God if they were taken there? What did they say about music? What did they say about otherworldly beings being present in heaven? You know, beings that we're not accustomed to seeing. You know, we see strange beings here on this earth. Octopus and all, you know, all kinds of underwater sea creatures that are like, what is that thing? You know, I mean, we have a smorgasbord of life forms on this earth, but most of us are reasonably acquainted with the majority of them. But evidently there are beings, creatures, living beings that are in heaven that are not indigenous to this planet. So by definition, they would be called what? Okay, otherworldly beings. I won't use the word. Don't want to confuse anybody. But anyway, the point is that when you look at the things that match, you come away with an analysis conclusion that's rather shocking. And that is that the body of knowledge that has come back from this wide array of diverse people over decades of time, in some cases going back into the 1800s, as with the testimony of Rebecca Springer from My Dream of Heaven, which is a free book, a wonderful book. What you find is this uncanny, this supernatural alignment of key elements that is just, it's one of those things that you just can't practice. You know what I mean? You would really, and then what would be the point? You know, in critical analysis, in critical thinking, which is a skill that so very, 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 very few people have, unfortunately, and it's a powerful blessing when you are blessed by the Lord to have the skill of critical thinking. Critical thinking makes you ask questions. There's a great, here, let me give you an example. If you go out on the internet and you search for, it's one of those conspiracy movies, it's fantastically well done. It's called the 7-7 ripple effect. In fact, it was so controversial in the United Kingdom that my understanding was under European Union law, one of the guys who was pushing this particular documentary, they actually threw him in jail. It's just a sad testimony, really, but it also speaks to the veracity of the data that's included in it, because it was upsetting and threatening people in positions of authority, evidently, in the UK, and they had to shut this guy up. It's called the 7-7 ripple effect, and what he does throughout that entire documentary in the 7-7 ripple effect is he explains this concept known as what he calls qui bono. Or depending on how you pronounce it. Some people say quid bono, qui bono. What it means is who benefits. It's the same type of critical thinking that you're supposed to apply when you're sitting as a, you're on a capital crimes case in the jury, and there are people's lives at stake, and you've got to really think hard and put your thinking cap on and understand the ramifications of your thought. Well, in the 7-7 ripple effect documentary, the fellow goes on quid bono, over and over again, he says it, over and over, over and over, over and over, because he's trying to hammer the concept into the listeners, into the person that he's talking to in the video, in the documentary. He's trying to hammer that concept into their heads, because it is so utterly crucial, vital, that the person watching it understands that concept, because it is elemental in you getting it, to see that it had to have been orchestrated by the forces of darkness. Because when you apply the concept of quid bono, who benefits, what was their motivation? Think about it. Unless the person's a serial killer, when there is a murder, e.g. capital crimes type of a case out there in the courts of law in many, many developed countries across the world, even in the Roman Empire, the original Roman Empire, which put together the first, similar type of court. And, even Paul, the Apostle Paul, when he said, that I forget his exact words toward the very end of Acts, but he said that I appeal to Caesar. The law was very similar to what we have today in the court system. Quid bono, when you apply that, is fascinating, because it helps you with your critical thinking. When you say the words, who benefits, what would be the point? Why would somebody do that? Now, for example, a person comes on the radio show and they say, hey, I wrote a book. It's a book about Jesus. It's a book about Nephilim. It's a book about aliens and UFOs. And you're listening to the author speak, and you ask yourself, why would that person write that book? To make money? See, that's the normal thing that people think, to make money. Folks, if you understood that authorship of books is always a lose-lose, it's like making money writing a book is like trying to make money like becoming a member of the new Van Halen with your new guitar. Like you just went over to Sam Ash Music, you bought yourself your first guitar, and you're going to sit down and you're going to tell your mom and dad, hey, mom and dad, I'm going to be part of the new Van Halen. The odds of you making any money with that guitar are probably like 1 in 50 bazillion. And it's the same way with books. But our minds, we always default to the dark side. Why do we do that? It's got to be our DNA. It's got to be the fallen state of who we are as fallen beings on this earth. We always go to the negative instead of the positive. Authors of books don't make money. 99.9%, if not 99.99999% of authors who've wrote books lost money writing the books. Unless they, you know, if you give them even 50 cents an hour for the time that they invested into writing the book, they lost money. It is extremely rare that they actually make any money that means anything at all. All right. But we don't know that. So we go. So if you say, well, then what else would be their motivation? If they're not going to make any money writing the book and they're spending all this time going on radio shows and telling people about it, what's their motivation? Quid bono? Quid bono? Tell me, what is the motivation for them to do it? Let's think of a reason why they would do it. And you can't. Not really. Not unless you're stretching it and you're just inherently negative. If you're one of those people who just leans to the negative all the time. But, you know, I don't think that's how Jesus wants us to live. As a matter of fact, I got scriptures that tell you the opposite, that we're not supposed to live like that. All right, praise Jesus. And so when you create a table and you look at all these people, spiritlessons.com is one place, which is also the same website as divinerevelations.info, which has bunches of people that have been taken to heaven there. You know, nothing breaks my heart more than when a person who's been taken to heaven disparages another person who's been taken to heaven. I think that the better way to look at this is that not everybody saw everything exactly the same. When you analyze it, quid bono? To what benefit could they possibly, you know, maybe they didn't hear the same, maybe they didn't see the same part of heaven, maybe they were shown up more, maybe or less, maybe they saw, like, maybe I know for sure that many of them have only been taken into the city of God. Not, there are several that I've studied that have never been taken into the outer environments. They have never been taken out in the countryside. They have never been taken out in the distant valley areas that are way far away from the city of God. They haven't seen it. And so naturally they say things like, you know, oh, no, that doesn't exist. Because in their tour, when they went on the tour, or the hundreds of tours perhaps that they went on, Odin Edrick had over 80 tours, so who knows how many. And I can't even get you going on how many other people have been there many times. They go to different places a lot of times. Odin Hetrick's daughter didn't see the same things Odin Hetrick saw. True Thomas saw different things than Elvis Apatis saw. Jesse Duplantis saw different things than Odin Hetrick saw. It doesn't mean anybody's telling a fib. It just means they saw different things. And there's the other part of that too, and that is we feel different things. We're all human. We believe things. We believe things. What am I saying when I say that? What I'm saying is we see something, but if you take five people, this is absolutely scientific fact. Kenneth, you got the PhD, so you know I definitely want you to comment on this. But if you take five people and you bring them into a room, you show them a movie that's 5 minutes long, you show them, let's say, 5 1-minute pictures of something, And then you take them out, you put them in a separate room, and you interrogate them, you know, and you say, excuse me, but can you tell me on slide number one, what did you see? Describe it as best as you can. And you write it down. Okay, and you saw this, and you saw that. Okay, very good. Bring in person number two. Person number two comes in. On slide number one, what did you see? Can you describe it? Okay, you saw this and that. You're going to get a completely separate description from every single person that you bring in the room. However, you will probably have the majority of the description be right, but there will be nuances that are slightly different that individual will swear on a stack of Bibles is absolutely the way it was because that's what they believe. It doesn't mean that the other four people were wrong. It just means that that one person emphatically or passionately believes that one particular thing is this way and this way only. What's called critical thinking. Praise Jesus. Critical thinking is understanding that there's really no motivation. They're not going to get a secret check from the Joint Chiefs of Staff and the Pentagon because they told a particular version. It doesn't mean that everybody else that went to heaven was wrong. It simply means that there are deltas, there's variances in how the human psyche perceives things, and some people tend to be more dogmatic about stuff than other people do. And when that happens, there's a small percentage of stuff that each person has seen or did not see or whatever that might vary. If we took the table and we look at the stuff that's the same, and then you apply the principle of quid bono to it, who benefits? Who's getting a big check? Who's retired who's going to retire over in the French Riviera? Nobody. Look. Who benefits? Does the devil benefit when somebody such as Sister Kat comes on this show, praise Jesus for her work, comes on a radio show, tours around the world, and tells people that they got to get the sin out of their lives and live holy in order to be able to be part of the kingdom of heaven? Does the devil benefit by that? Absolutely not. So the only conclusion must be that that individual was taken to heaven. Don't you see? They're not, you know, that and so we got to all start thinking more positively, look at the data, line it up in a table, see how many amazing things are exactly the same, how many testimonies align. The streets are gold. They have educational centers and places where you learn and amusement. Look, there, Sister Kat, for example, says that she'd seen amusement parks in heaven, and some people are like, oh, that's crazy. Why would that be true? Well, guess what? Go back and listen to Odin Hetrick's testimony of heaven from way back. Now, he's long gone, and he's with Jesus now. But Odin Hetrick and his daughter both testified to this thing they called, I think they called it the cup of the cup. It was some kind of an amusement park ride. I can't explain it. I have to go back and listen to it. But it had to do with where Jesus said, Father, take this cup from me. Father, take this cup from me. If it is at all possible, take this cup from me. Well, evidently the Father, there's this place where the saints can go. It's within view, I guess, of the throne room area or whatnot. So I guess it's in the city of God. But there's it's. She said they were explaining it, and I'm like, that's kind of bizarre. I thought it was so weird that I almost wanted to discount it. But they described how the saints loved to go there, and they would get on it, and it was like some kind of a Ferris wheel thing, and they would spin around and around and around and around, almost like Ezekiel's wheel. praise Jesus, but spin, and they loved it. It was called the Cup of Praise, I think is what they referred to it, if I remember properly. And then I thought, oh, wait a minute, Kat Kerr's saying that there's amusement rides. And then the Cup of Praise that Odin Hetrick talked about over 15 years ago on his account. And it all starts to match. And then you're like, wow. So if we could just look at these things through the eyes of children, if we could have the hearts of Jesus, hearts of the Father and love for one another, and be more accepting and less critical and look at the things, because we need good news. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. There's too much darkness in this world. Amen. And because you know what? It's going to get darker out there. And so it's time for, you know, the saints to occasionally step away from being watchmen or whatever you want. If you want to call yourself a watchman on the wall, well, God bless you. All right, amen. But we all watchmen on the wall, regardless, need to take some time off and look at the cool stuff, the awesome stuff. Take off the critical thinking, you know, take off the negativity hat. Ask yourself, why not? Why not? And always assume that there are going to be things that different people have seen and stuff that maybe they didn't remember exactly right. Doesn't matter. Don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. Give glory to Jesus for the things that we can embrace, the things that we can find in our Bible, the things that match the testimonies of the many other people. And thank you, Jesus, because we're not from here and that's where we're going. Hallelujah. And guess what? That's just probably just home base. When you think about it, we got to come back and rule and reign with Jesus in the new millennium. For 1,000 years, which will probably go by like Shazam. And then what? You ever thought about that? So heaven is like our home base. We don't even know what comes after all that. And it's probably going to be 10 times more glorious than our wildest imagination. So it's time for us to embrace these things, get excited about who we are, and get ready so that when the darkness does roll through our neighborhoods, we don't care. We're just here to bring along as many people as we possibly can to the kingdom of heaven with us. Praise be to the name of the Lord God. Hallelujah. The kingdom of God is at hand. I raise my hands before you, Jesus, and I thank you for this wonderful opportunity. And on that note, Kenneth?
you know, Johnny, what you're talking about is minding our perceptions. And there was a great artist from the 1700s and 1800s, and anybody that knows me knows that I know all about artists because at Terry and we watch a lot of movies about artists. But there was an artist named William Blake. He was a Christian. And folks, if you ever saw that picture of the Ancient of Days, he used to paint like Bible scenes, but it's the one where God's kind of reaching down from heaven. And he's got the long hair blowing. It's called the Ancient of Days. Well, this is something that Blake said about perceptions. Listen to this. He said, if the doors of perception were cleansed, everything would appear as it is, infinite. For man has closed himself up till he sees all things through narrow chinks of his cavern. So like what Blake was saying is we're all in these little caves and we're looking out the front of our cave and we see this little slice of reality, but if we just let that go, let our perceptions go, and really allow the Holy Spirit to work in us, wow, look out. You know, because most people that don't do that, they see the world, they feel the world, or they hear the world, but they don't allow the Holy Spirit to reveal things to it. Paul told us that. He said it so well. He said, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. But the Spirit reveals it, for the Spirit seeks all things, even the deep things of God. So what we have to recognize is that our perceptions can deceive us. And if you don't believe that, did you ever see the picture? You know, it's a black and white picture. And then you're asked, what do you see? And some people see two faces looking at each other, and other people see a chalice. Well, which is it? Or how about that one where it just looks like a very loose, almost expressionistic drawing, and some people see an old lady looking down, and others see a very young, vibrant woman with a bonnet on. Which is it? It's a matter of perception. So the thing we have to do is allow the Spirit to speak to us so that we can see all things, even the deep things of God.
Amen. And if your spirit, this gets into some really deep, deep spiritual warfare stuff. But I mean, if you've got soul scars, which we all have some soul scars, and we have to cleanse ourselves of the soul scars and in the crystal rivers of life and all that kind of stuff. That's another thing that matches from testimony to testimony to testimony to testimony. Praise Jesus. But, you know, depending on how deep your soul scars are and how many of your soul scars have not been cleansed through the sanctification process yet, you're going to have a tendency to lean toward the negativity, the negative side, because you've got yucky stuff in your soul. It takes a long time, to a lot of praise, a lot of worship, a lot of seeking the Lord, a lot of declarations. You know, again, folks, if you want a copy of the declarations, they're on tribulation-now.org. You can go there. These are declarations. These are holy declarations. We need, and Sister Kat Kerr is real big on making declarations. Praise Jesus. She understands the power in our tongue, the power in our words, the power that Jesus gave us, and these declarations are vital. You can just search for holy declarations in the black banner section. Look very carefully. You'll see it. Holy declarations. And I declare, I use these declarations in my spiritual warfare prayer all the time. Praise Jesus. Hallelujah. So, and folks, let me just give you an example of what I'm talking about, what Kenneth and I are talking about here. All right. So, there are entire, by the way, just in case you didn't know, you can go to Wikipedia and check up on me. Or wherever you want to go and do your homework, there are over 33,000 different Christian denominations. Huh? Amen? All right. Just for example, just look at the Christian denominations that are known as Sabbatarians. Okay? What amazes me is that people who preach about, keeping the Sabbath, or else you're going to go to hell. You're going to go to hell if you don't keep the Sabbath. Okay? That's what they preach. They actually believe that stuff. And there's a lot of them, folks. And they are, oh boy, they are dogmatic. They're like, they'll kick you out of the church. They'll send you to the street packing. Oh, you worked on Saturday. Oh boy, you're in big trouble. Well, isn't it fascinating what the Bible actually says? Nobody teaches this. I have DVDs in my collection by absolutely astute, fabulous teachers of the Bible that have tried to tackle this subject, but yet it stupefies me that they miss the last verse in what Jesus said. For example, Matthew 5:17-20. Jesus says, "Do not think that I came to destroy the law or the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For assuredly I say to you, till heaven and earth pass away, not one jot or tittle will by no means pass from the law until it's fulfilled." So what happens is at that point, everybody stops reading and they go, "Well, then we got to create ourselves another denomination. We're going to call ourselves the Super Sabbatarians." And now we're up to 33,001 denominations. Too bad they didn't read the next verse where Jesus explains it. And he says, "Whosoever, therefore, breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches men so, shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven." In the kingdom of heaven. No one's getting sent to hell over it. It's a matter of rewards in heaven. And then the next clause in the sentence is, "But whoever does and teaches them, he shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven." So basically what this is simply saying is that if you really love the Lord your God with all your heart, your mind, and your soul, you're going to be interested in the Old Testament. You're going to be interested in learning about the feast of the Lord in Leviticus 23. When Sukkot goes by, you're going to want to know about Sukkot. You're going to want to know about Pentecost. You're going to want to know about a Shavuot. You're going to want to know these things because that's how much you love the Father. And they're all shadows of things to come. So we're going to have to learn about them later. Anyway, praise Jesus. But it has to do with being called least in the kingdom of heaven and being called great. It doesn't have to do with separating and creating additional denominations. That is demonic. But we succumb to the forces of darkness so easily because we have a terrible tendency to lean toward the negativity. Listen, I'll give you another example. There are Christian groups out there. Oh my goodness! But there, I could give hundreds. There's hundreds of examples. Kenneth and I could do two 6-hour radio shows back to back on this subject. Praise Jesus! But here's another example. There are people out there, churches, different churches and denominations and such like that, that will say, it is absolutely impossible for somebody to have been taken to heaven, because it says in the Bible, no one has seen God. It also says in Daniel 12 that there will come a time when the dead in the earth will rise up, and then Paul in 1 Corinthians 15:52 said, the dead in Christ shall by no means precede those who are alive, and then they will rise up so it means nobody could have seen anybody alive in heaven, right? Because the dead in Christ got to rise, right? And the dead, and we haven't come to that time yet, right? Wrong. All right. How could I say such an awful thing? Well, I'll tell you. It's because it's in the Bible. I'm going to read it to you right here. So why don't you go ahead, if you really want to scratch your head, and get out your Bible and read 1 Corinthians 15:52 and the surrounding verses. 1 Corinthians 15:52, and put it side by side with 2 Corinthians 12:1. Because when you do, you're going to go, uh-oh, SpaghettiOs. 2 Corinthians 12:1. This is Paul speaking. It's doubtless not profitable to me to boast. I will come to visions and revelations of the Lord. I know a man in Christ who, 14 years ago, whether in body, I do not know. Whether out of body, I do not know. God knows. Such as one was caught up to the third heaven. Bingo. Isn't that awesome? I love the mysteries in the Bible. I love them, love them, love them, love them, love them, because it keeps us on our toes. It keeps us humble. 1 Corinthians 8:2. If anyone thinks they know anything, they know nothing yet as they ought to know. Praise Jesus. We should be excited about the stuff we don't know. It just opens up so many possibilities. Our God is so big, so huge. Our Jesus is so amazing. And we don't realize, you look at the sacrifice. You look at God come down in the flesh, and he gave and he suffered and went through that, and even through all the hell that he was put through here on this earth, he hangs on the cross. It's God incarnate in the flesh, and what does he say? Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. Even at the last split second before he passed, he thought God had forsaken him, and he was God come in the flesh, part of the triune, the Holy Spirit, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, separate but one. What a cool concept that is. Praise Jesus. Kenneth?
The thing that we have to recognize is, and I love this, and I probably saw it about maybe 4 or 5 years ago, we're not physical beings having a spiritual experience. We're spiritual beings having a physical experience. And when you really start to see things like that, you recognize that everything we do is spiritual. It's not that you do spiritual things on Sunday and then you get back into the secular realm, Monday through Saturday. Everything is spiritual. The only question is it sacred and holy in the eyes of God? Does it reach him in the heavenly throne room as a sweet aroma which pleases him? Or is it an abomination in his eyes and a stench to his nose? So when we start to recognize that, and we walk in the spirit, not in the flesh, then life becomes so much more exciting, so much more powerful, because you're doing what you were created to do. Have fellowship with the Father through the supernatural link we have with the Holy Spirit. We're in koinonia. And when you do that, life just takes on such a different perspectives. Your perception of everything changes.
Yeah, it does. Praise God. It's so exciting. But Kenneth, you spent, how many years did you spend in postgraduate work getting that impossible to get degree? How many years did you spend getting that degree, that impossible to get degree in chemistry, that's probably barely surpassed in difficulty by even physics? I'd say it's right up there. But I mean, how many years?
After high school, it was a total of 9 years, graduate and undergraduate. So
that's a
long time. Most people had families; they had children that were approaching teenage years, and I'm just graduating.
Well, Kenneth, you may be the most highly educated person listening to this show right now. Certainly, you got me beat big time. So I got a question for you. Are we there yet?
Are we there yet?
No.
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 Are we there yet?
You little...
I swear to you.
Woohoo!
Praise God, hallelujah. And because, you know, sometimes we get, you know, charged with the being too doomy and gloomy on this radio show, which, of course, if you really knew this ministry and you had listened to, you know, enough of our work, you would know. We get, you know what the funny thing about it is, Kenneth? Ever think about this? We have gotten, you know, lambasted for being too jovial. And we've gotten lambasted for being too doomy. So it's kind of like you can't find, there's no place that you can be, you know, that makes everybody happy. We're either too happy or we're too doomy, too doomy and gloomy. But anyway, on that note, I'm going to play this little bit, this little ditty. It's like 60 seconds long. It's a thing that I did a long time ago. Called a doom rant for Jesus. Call it a doom rant for Jesus. It's got the 1812 overture in the background. But this is how we have to think about this stuff. We don't want to get wrapped up in the fact that we're, oh, no, you know, oh. You know, because our Bible warns us. Our Bible admonishes us that if we're friends of the earth, we are at enmity with God. He who is like in love with the things of the earth is at enmity, hatred with God. There should be nothing here for us. We're not from here. Nothing here for us. So when we're pointing out the things that are happening that are apocalyptic across this world, they have an outcome. And that is what we should be focused on. Praise Jesus. Listen to this. I want to believe that we are going to be out of here very, very soon. I want to believe that all heck is going to break loose anytime now, and we're going to roll right into the third seal, that the global financial collapse is going to hit, that all heck is going to break loose across the earth, and that our time here on this earth is extremely limited. We go right into the sixth seal, the 3 days of darkness, the harvest, and we're out of here. Praise Jesus. I want to get off this alien demon-infested rock. I want to be with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I want to do it more than anything in my entire life. I'm absolutely obsessed with the kingdom, and I'm obsessed with Jesus Christ, my King. Praise God, and I hope that all of you are too. We should be excited about this. And that's what we're doing here tonight. Praise God. We're here to talk about these scary things because these scary things have an outcome. And that outcome is what every person who's a member of the Bride of Jesus Christ should be looking forward to more than your next breath of air. Praise God. I remember, hey, Kenneth, back in 2011, when I remember there were times when I would wake up in the morning and I'd be like patting my chest going, oh, doggone it, I'm still here. Remember that?
Oh, I remember you. I remember, do you remember some of those conversations you'd call me and, Kenneth, this is it. This is absolutely it. I'm positive. And you were talking to the guy that has a case of 88 reasons sitting here in the other room. So I'm like, I know he's coming, and I know it's going to be at any moment, and I know it could be before I finish this sentence, but I don't want to use the word jaded, but I'm just starting to realize that it's his timing and not mine.
No, right, amen. And the other thing that we have to be very, very, very careful about is that I'm not going to name names, folks, because it would cast the wrong message out there. But I'm Kenneth. Am I not obsessive in my research and study and things like that? I'm pretty obsessive, right? Wouldn't you say?
That would be like putting it mildly.
Exactly. I should be drug away with a rubber. I should have like one of those like, you know, white suits and put in the corner with some mush peas so I can sing, you know, like, you know, Swing Low, Sweet Chariot until Jesus comes. I get it. I'm absolutely obsessed with the kingdom. And so I get obsessive with my research and I look for minute details about things. And one of the things that you will take note of is that virtually every person that's been taken to heaven seems to have a time distortion, which, by the way, gets back to that concept of 1 Corinthians 15:52, placed side by side with 2 Corinthians 12:2. They are absolutely in contradiction with one another, unless you understand that God has different realms. They're realms, 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 for lack of a better term. Realms, okay? And I think it would be foolhardy for anybody out there, including people taken to heaven, to think that they have it all figured out, right? You know, we tend to feel like we do, but what I've noticed is one of the areas of inconsistency has to do with time-space distortion. Okay, and so what happens is, as Brother Jim Wilhelmson has put it, also Chuck Misler puts it this way as well, God's eternal realm is like a helicopter looking over a parade route. He sees the beginning from the end. And we think of that in terms of only our realm, right? What about the other realms? What about the other dimensions? What about the potentially thousands, if not tens of thousands or more, of other dimensions? And do other dimensions have parallel universes in them? Okay. So when you think in terms of a universe, you think in terms of, okay, that is universal, therefore the root word is, you know, it's universe, so it's everything. So a universe should be all-inclusive, amen? Oops, what about when you change it from channel 34 to channel 75? It's a whole other dimension. There's a whole other universe there. Praise Jesus. Now what if there are thousands of universes? All parallel, all happening simultaneously. Holy mackerel. Genesis 2, verse 4. And these are the generations of the heavens and the earth. Read it, it's plural. The generations of the heavens of the earth. What does that all mean? So when you get your arms around that, you understand that it's so much more awesome than we can get our arms around. Our brains are too tiny. We don't have the intellectual capacity to understand it. So if you were to sit in front of Jesus right now and say, Jesus, are the dead going to rise? Are the dead going to rise from their graves and precede those who are, you know, like first? And Jesus is going to go, yep. And he say, but Jesus, are there people in heaven right now? And Jesus is going to go, yep. See, the problem is it's always all of the above. It's not one or the other. It's all of the above. It's amazing how awesome that is. And people are like, well, that's a discrepancy in the Bible. So the whole Bible is a bunch of mythology, and I just can't believe it. And I was like, you know what? It's because you just don't perceive things spiritually. When you perceive things spiritually and you get the tip of the iceberg, at least the tip of the iceberg, just enough of the tip of the iceberg to maybe make yourself a little faith snow cone. Then you're like, oh, that's really cool. So, anyway, praise Jesus. It's exciting. It's exciting to know these things. It's exciting to know that you don't know nothing. That makes it even more exciting. Praise God. Now we're going to go ahead and move into some of the prophecies. It's a couple of them that just came out today. Praise God. Praise Jesus. This one's out just today, I believe, from God's Healer 7. This is a prophecy given to Brother Dan. It's entitled, Reveal the Terror of the Nations, Speak His Name. Listen close.
Brother Dan?
Glad to be here again on God's Healer 7. It's like a two-for-one, because first I got to tell you a vision I had.
And Brother Dan hates to put visions up.
Yes, I do.
What?
I only, about 4 or 6 months ago. It was really quick. It was like three slides. The first slide is I'm looking down the earth, and I can see Italy. I can see all of the Mediterranean Sea, and I can see where all these bombs have dropped. They're not nuclear. They're just conventional, but I can see where they all went. And as I'm looking, I watch a bomb drop, and I actually see it implode. So where was this? It was from France all the way over to Turkey. It was from Algiers all the way over to Israel, Syria, that place, and there was a lot of them. It was like 40, 50, 60. It was more than I could count. And the last piece, which I just told Sister Barbara, was the third slide, was I'm looking like out a screen door, but it's all gold. And I had no idea what that meant until you just told me. So I got this word, and you'll see it's referred to there what I didn't say before, because I don't like doing it. I got this word on October 3rd of 2015. Speak now, Son of Man. Speak all that I tell you. Look to the east, for an ill wind blows. Shall the fig tree not shed its fruit? For everything has a season. The claws of war gather, for the day of vengeance draws near. Shall all not tremble on the great and terrible day of the Lord? Let the watchman be vigilant, for the armies of evil prepare for your destruction. Shall the truth not fight your battle this day? Time shall tally the wickedness of this evil generation. Speak now, Son of Man. Reveal what is in men's hearts. Shall treachery not be revealed in the light of day? Shall evil not tickle the ears of those who have lost their way? Speak now, Son of Man. Speak of the destruction that I have shown you. You have seen it with your own eyes, but have not revealed it. Many who speak of justice will speak deceit. Reveal the terror of nations. Speak his name. He calls himself Vladimir the Great. He shall try to silence the word and humble those who oppose him. He wears the robe of revenge and walks down the path of destruction. I shall use him to serve my purpose, and all shall see the power of the Lord. Amen.
I shall use him for my purpose. Well, those of us who, you know, know who Babylon the Great is and know who, you know, listening to the Prophecies, Dreams, and Visions, A.A. Allen, 1954, one of the most amazingly anointed divine faith healers. A.A. Allen was shown the United States being destroyed by missiles that jumped out of the ocean like fish. Wow. Back in 1954, there were not submarine-launched nuclear missiles. They didn't exist. Henry Groover. Holy cow, praise Jesus for his testimony. Dimitri Didiman, another person, praise God. So many confirmations from the throne room of God, hallelujah. Revelation 18, that's about us. Babylon the Great, praise God. So, yes, amen. Praise Jesus. This one is from Wings of Prophecy, just came out today. It's entitled A Season of Great Change from Sister Glenda Linkus. My children know these are perilous times, very perilous indeed. For some, you have entered into a season of great change, my children, and these changes shall affect you personally. My judgment always begins with my own. If my own people do not show forth my standards in the earth, who will? I shall judge those who call themselves by my glorious name, yet walk in sin now, continue to refuse me. I shall heap hardships upon until they realize their need for me and repent, or until they perish. The righteous, my children who truly walk in my ways, shall experience change, good changes for you. My children are being promoted into a higher level of my work and abundance. You live in perilous times, my children, but those who serve me, who walk in my ways, will see only blessings. And of course, when the Father says these things, he's speaking of them from a heavenly realm standpoint. That when the that means gifts of the Holy Spirit, powers from Jesus, a supernatural peace, a protection from angels, those kinds of things. He's not talking about you're going to get a new promotion in that VP position at work, right, Kenneth?
you know, brother. What we just have to take to heart is recognize that the Lord promotes. So if you just kind of do your best and not worry about all that, the Lord will promote. Yeah, it's not what it means, though.
Yeah, praise God. And seek ye first the kingdom and the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will be given unto you. And it's so critical that we get every word of the scripture, not one jot or tittle. We can't breeze over stuff. There's always, things are conditional. And his righteousness. Praise Jesus. And then all these other things will be taken. So we don't have to worry. We don't have to worry as long as we fear God and are living in holiness, separated from society, and righteousness. That's, righteousness is basically turning away. If you goof up, you sin, you make a mistake, you repent of it. You don't do it anymore. Tell the Father, I'm sorry. If we confess of our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9. Praise Jesus. Hallelujah. That's powerful. But we have to confess it. We got to get on our knees and say, Father, I'm sorry. I hit myself with a hammer and I dropped some awful cuss words and stuff in front of the kids, and I'm sorry, Father, I shouldn't have done it. Please, forgive me. That's how we are to live our lives. Praise God. Very powerful. Thank you, Jesus. And then there was another prophecy that came out. It's not very long, from God's Healer 7. This is Sister Barbara, and its title is There Was a Silence in Heaven for About a Half an Hour, and I gave it a kind of like a little subtitle so I can find it later. It shall end. In other words, the implication is that the silence in heaven is about to end and that the strong delusion comes. So again, another warning about the strong delusion. Men's hearts failing them for fear of things which come upon the earth.
This is the time that has been spoken to you from your elders and prophets. This is the great and dreadful day. It is upon you. Many of you have fallen asleep, grown weary and tired, and now are in the slumber of darkness. Since the beginning, many I have called to serve me, and by doing so have served others. during trials and tribulations, they continue some even to their own death. Others I've called to serve grew frustrated and turned away. Many when they were needed the most. They left their calling to pursue their own selfish desires. Their seed withered and died. You have been told not everyone will enter the kingdom. It is truth. You have been given instruction how to enter in. Instead of taking heed of the messages and those messengers I have sent to you, you chose to debate my instruction. Because of this, many have fallen away. You hypocrites, you are like the Pharisees in the temple. Instead of saying, I am a sinner and repenting, you continue to go on boasting about your great accomplishments and what you have acquired. Everything you have, I have given you. Do you have such a blind eye? Does this pride go unnoticed by you? You live in darkness. You have never seen the light. The silence in heaven shall end. Prepare my children of the light. The strong delusion comes, and my sons and daughters, you shall see what others cannot. You will see in the darkness. Do not be deceived by the world or its light. Continue on your path and follow the light.
Praise God. And now for the news.
Not normal.
All right, praise Jesus. Listen to this. This may go down, at least in my opinion anyway, as the greatest speech ever at the United Nations. This is Netanyahu addressing the United Nations on the Iran nuclear deal. Listen to this. It's epic. Listen to how he pauses. And take note that when he's pausing and you hear the silence, the pause, the long pause, he is glaring at every single person in the entire building. Long overdue. Hallelujah. Listen to this.
Home to over 6 million Jews. He pledged, quote, there will be no Israel in 25 years. End quote. 70 years after the murder of 6 million Jews, Iran's rulers promised to destroy my country, murder my people, and the response from this body, the response from nearly every one of the governments represented here has been absolutely nothing. Utter silence. Deafening silence.
Right now he's glaring at every single person in the building, turning his head from the left to the right, looking at him, accusing him as he ought. God bless that man. Wow. Praise Jesus. That is a powerful
Perhaps you
statement.
Can understand why Israel is not joining you in celebrating this deal. If Iran's rulers were working to destroy your countries, perhaps you'd be less enthusiastic about the deal. If Iran's terror proxies were firing thousands of rockets at your cities, perhaps you'd be more measured in your praise. And if this deal were unleashing a nuclear arms race in your neighborhood, perhaps you'd be more reluctant to celebrate.
Wow. Powerful. Kenneth, it was you a long time ago that said sometimes a long pause makes a strong point. 45 seconds he glared at every single person in the United Nations. What a powerful, epic speech.
I saw that in boardrooms, and I saw that across negotiating tables and in workout sessions when you're in arbitration. Those silences are, they speak volumes. They're deafening. And what they'll do is they'll unnerve anyone who's not grounded. And they're used so well by so many people, and Netanyahu did it right there. He did it. He nailed it, brother.
He was angry. He was very mad. I would not
and
like
you know
that.
What? Let's put that all aside for a minute. He made a very powerful point there. I don't think you'd be celebrating if there was an arms race built up in your backyard. And that's literally what's happening there. And you know what? It's not like it's just speculation. The leader of Iran came right out and said it.
Oh, yeah.
Like, in our faces. This is so pathetic. It's so sick. The American people just need to wake up, but I think it's too late. Like, who was that? Sister Glenda? Yeah, Sister Glenda
yes.
Lincoln said, it's too late. It's too late.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I wish we had time to play that, but we don't. Praise God. All right, praise Jesus. Now listen to this headline. This is awful, but it happened. And most people in the United States probably did not even hear about it. MSF Hospital, U.S. condemned over horrific bombing in Afghanistan. The United States has been condemned for launching an airstrike at the Medecins Sans Frontieres Doctors Without Borders charity hospital in Afghanistan, which is believed to have killed up to 20 people. The hospital was hit during an aerial bombardment on Saturday morning in the besieged city of Kunduz, destroying a large portion of the facility. An MSF source told The Guardian that up to 20 Afghan members of the staff and patients were killed and dozens were injured, adding that the death toll could rise further. Among the killed were 9 MSF staff. This is Doctors Without Borders staff. And 7 patients from the intensive care unit, including 3 children. And the whole story is just now beginning to unfold. I'm not going to repeat some of it because I'll just sit here and bawl like a baby because it's just unbelievably horrible. They even radioed. They were like calling on the radio. They called on the radio, got a hold of the military people, said, stop bombing us, stop bombing us. And they continued to bomb them for more than 30 more minutes. That would be bombs from, you know, praise Jesus. Listen to this. Russia claims ISIS now on the ropes as fighters desert after 60 airstrikes in 72 hours. So again, and this is coming from multiple news sources, folks. This isn't just Russia. This is multiple other news sources across the world from many different sources. Basically, Russia's going in there. They're bombing the dickens out of both groups of terrorists, which is what they all are, and guess what? They're actually making progress, and it's upsetting the Pentagon, because heaven forbid we should actually do something and get rid of the problem. Anyway, we live in an upside-down world, folks. It is a very upside-down world. Praise Jesus. Listen to this. This is a headline. It's not a headline. This is kind of like insider information, possibly insider information. This is from Sister Cathy. She monitors stuff like this through Twitter and things, and she got an alert that tracks back to a particular YouTuber, but the bottom line is this. Evidently, Temple University in Philadelphia has sent out alerts, supposedly, and I'll probably get this not exactly correct. I'm doing the best I can with what little information I have, that there's a possible attack that could be happening maybe tomorrow at Temple University. So if it's not bad enough, all the stuff that happened in Oregon and all that, and yes, folks, I know, all the conspiracy channels and YouTubers out there are going to come out. They're going to do the same thing they did with Sandy Hook. They're going to do the same thing they did with the Aurora shooting in that, and they're going to come out and try to say that it never happened. The problem is that, yes, stuff is orchestrated. Yes, there's mind control stuff involved. Yes, they are doing these things against it. Yes, it's very dark, but it's not that it didn't happen. It's that it's answer D. It's all of the above. Not, you know, don't rule out that it didn't happen. Think about it. There's no way they could pull it off. There's no way they could promulgate, orchestrate, and fake the entire event without somebody or a bunch of people coming forward and saying, no, 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 wait a minute. This is absolutely – no. It's both, folks. It's answer D, all of the above. Praise Jesus. Now, listen to this. And this is Kenneth wanted us to play this, and it's so powerful. This is a testimony from the actual testimony on Fox News from Sister Kim Davis. That's the actual elected official, the clerk of the court. By the way, that's a pretty powerful elected official position, I'm here to tell you. A lot of people don't get that. The clerk of the court is a very powerful elected official position in any given county. Believe you me, I worked as a consultant for government agencies, and it's a very powerful elected. So this is a huge testimony coming from her on Fox News. Listen to this. And Kenneth, you know what? I want to play this. This is going to eat up the time that we have left before we got to bring on Kat. But it is such a powerful. I'm just flipping through the headlines here. I want to make sure, folks, there's so many. But not one of them that we can't roll over to the next show. I'm just taking a double check, a double glance.
This is worth playing, Johnny. This is
very
much worth.
I'm going to play this. I'm going to play this, Kenneth, because every single headline that we have here lined up, we can play it on the next show and not miss a trick. I mean, none of it is time sensitive. Praise Jesus. All right, so amen. Let's play this, folks, because this is how we all have to be. God bless her. Listen to this.
What religious doctrine or belief is it that you feel compels you not to do this?
Well, the Christian faith, you know, God's word states that a marriage is between one man and one woman, that, you know, and that's what rules my faith, you know.
Now, you've heard your critics. They say, we covered it in the piece, your critics say you too are a sinner, that you were married four times, twice to the same man, but divorced three times, that you had an affair while married, that you had children out of wedlock, and they look at you and say, who are you to judge others? To them you say what?
I've not judged anybody. I have given my life to Christ. I have been redeemed by the blood of Christ, and that's available to anybody that wants that. My sins are forgiven. They are thrown into a sea of forgetfulness from the time I gave my life to Him. Do I still sin? Maybe every now and then. You know, we're all flesh. We tend to say things maybe we don't, maybe say things that we shouldn't say, or you know, act in a way that's unbecoming, get angry, you know, without cause. But that's what repentance is all about. You know, you ask God to forgive you, and you vow not to do it anymore. You know, but we are flesh. To say that I'm a sinner, you know, I guess that's somebody judging me.
What about the couple with whom you had the confrontation? They said, we felt humiliated. We felt like second-class citizens. Can you understand that point of view?
When they first came in, they demanded that I talk to them. Nothing would do them, and they had cameras going and everything. So when I was talking to them, they wanted to know why I would not issue them the marriage license. And I simply told them about when God created Earth, He spoke everything into existence.
They said they went to get their marriage license pursuant to the law, and they didn't want a, quote, lecture in religion.
They wanted to know the reason why I wouldn't issue one, and I gave them the reason.
Mm-hmm. Do you think, you know, the argument on the other side is, well, if we're going to give a religious accommodation to someone like Kim Davis, then we're going to have to give a religious accommodation to an untold number of people, to Catholics who don't want to issue a license to somebody who's been divorced but was married in a Catholic church and didn't get it annulled, to a Muslim clerk who doesn't want to sanction the marriage of a Christian to a Muslim, and so on. Can you understand that argument?
Well, I could if I thought it was a valid argument, because for simply the fact is that marriage is defined as one man and one woman. It's not like black and white. You're not talking about a racial issue. You're not talking about, I'm just talking about marriage in general.
But other people in other religions have their own definitions of marriage and their own beliefs on who can and cannot marry. So the critics say this is a slippery slope. if we're going to bend the law or the rules for one person with one set of objections, then we're going to have to do it for a bunch of people with other objections.
So you have millions of Christians who object this whole same-sex marriage issue. Are their rights invalid? Are their rights not worth anything?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's a valid point, and it's a fight that's worth fighting for.
How about that? Because, you know, the president, even today, was talking about how in this country we stand for religious liberty. Do you believe that? Do you believe that still in the United States of America today?
In 2015, when a county clerk can go to jail because she is upholding her religious beliefs, I would have to question his statement.
So you decide you're going to stand on principle. You wind up getting word you're going to jail.
Mm-hmm.
Even though you knew it was a possibility, describe the moment you learned you were going.
There was a flood of emotions, of course, but when the marshals came around to get me, I stood up and I thanked Judge Bunning and I walked out with grace.
Not knowing how long you were going to be in jail for?
Didn't matter how long I was going to be in jail.
How long were you willing to stay?
As long as it took. I would stay till January, until legislation was put in, if that was what it took.
You could have been there for up to a year.
Sure.
Did you know that?
It didn't matter. Megan, when I gave my life to the Lord, I vowed to Him. I vowed to serve Him with my whole heart, mind, body, and soul, every bit of strength I had. And to me, that's a vow I want to keep, because it's a heaven or hell issue for me.
Even while you're sitting in a jail cell alone?
Yes, ma'am, I counted the joy. You know what I did while I was in there? I sang praises to Him to the top of my lungs. They probably thought I was insane in there.
Were you allowed to talk to anybody?
I was by myself, so I talked to the Lord.
Was it humbling?
Yeah.
I mean, somebody can see you at all times. There's no privacy. You know, you're a county clerk. You're an elected official of your county. And
you
the next thing you know, you're sitting
there.
Do you know
how many thumbs
up I got? In the jail.
People in the jail, hardened criminals, in there for over 10 years, got messages, said, let her know we're praying for her.
Imagine that. And folks, I used to do prison ministry work. Wow. Hardened criminals, 10 years plus. Let her know we are praying for her. See, some of the most incredible Christians I've ever met were some of the people in the jails. Sometimes until we have everything taken away from us, we're not willing to devote ourselves to the same level of, we just don't have what they have. That complete surrender. Kenneth?
That's what it takes in some people's lives. You know, it takes that total brokenness. And, you know, if the Lord can't get you with love, He's going to get you with fear, like Jude said. But then you learn His love. So whatever it takes, we need to come to Him on bended knee right now or later on the other side of eternity. He's going to break that knee with a rod of iron. So, folks, come to Jesus right now as your Lord and Savior, and you're going to learn the joy unspeakable, and that joy is going to become your strength, and you're going to find this love that goes beyond anything you can understand. And that's what Kim Davis had when she was in prison there. She had the strength that comes through the joy of the Lord. She reminded me of Paul and Silas while they were in prison there after getting thrown in for delivering that girl that was being used by the charlatans, you know, to make a living. You know, Paul just got so disgusted with it, he rebuked the demon and she was delivered. And then they got thrown in jail for destroying this guy's livelihood. But nonetheless, they're in prison, praising the Lord. And what happens? A great earthquake comes. The prison jailer, you know, he gets delivered, as does his household. And what was it, Lydia? Lydia was there, and she invited everybody over for a Bible study, and you got the formation of the Church of Philippi. So, folks, you don't know what's going to happen from her testimony there. How many people are going to come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ by the boldness this woman showed, the fearlessness she showed? Same thing Lazarus did after he was, you know, called up from the grave. So just have that fearlessness that comes through that joy that gives you strength. And you don't know what kind of impact that's going to have on countless lives.
Yeah, yeah, amen. Praise God. So very, very true. And okay, and I'm looking through this the console. We have a lot of callers in the queue. And I have the caller ID that was given to me, well, from prior shows that we've done with Sister Kat. And I am not seeing her caller ID. Oh, yes, I am. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I love it. All right. I'm so glad because I just love Kat Kerr. I just love her to pieces. Praise God. She's one of those people I'm going to be. When you see a fat guy wearing a Hawaiian shirt in heaven chasing this lady down the golden streets, well, then you'll know who's. I'm going after Kat Kerr. Praise God. Give her a big hug. All right. Hallelujah. All right. And we're going to bring her on right now. Praise Jesus. Whoops. Wrong button. We wanted the shofar. Here we go. tnradioshow@gmail.com TN Tango November for Tribulation Now. tnradioshow@gmail.com Send your questions into there. We got a bunch already queued up. Praise God. Let's see if we got Sister Kat on the line. Are you there?
Oh, I'm here.
Oh, praise God. We're so happy to have you. You know what? There's so much, you know, darkness in the world out there nowadays, and it's just, people just need to hear the good news. People need to understand why, you know, why are we excited about Jesus? Why are we excited about these awesome blessings that our Father has set up for us? You know, help us, you know, to, you know, become motivated and understand that, you know, the very really relatively minor changes that we willingly should employ in our daily lives to walk in holiness and righteousness, to seek the Lord, are just so full of unfathomable rewards that we can't even imagine them in our wildest dreams. And it's just such a blessing to have you come on and help people understand how glorious heaven is and how awesome our Father God is.
I always enjoy sharing, but especially now in this time, because God has a plan for this time, and it's not our plan. It's really to stand up and take authority. And the more you walk in holiness, the more dangerous you become against the darkness. I think that's one of my favorite things about walking holy, choosing to walk holy. Some people think you can't walk free from sin. Yes, you can. You just choose it.
Yep.
You have to choose it. You have a will. You just say no, and then, you know what? Sin isn't even in my understanding anymore. It's not even a part of my makeup. I never even consider it. And actually, darkness stays as far away from me as they can.
Yep. Rebuke the devil, and he will flee from you. You know, I have.
Yeah.
I've had people tell me across the table in mixed company, and say things to me like, you know, because I would be telling them, we have to live sin-free. And they're like, you know, you can't live sin-free. And I'm like, yes, you can. Otherwise, you make Jesus a fibber. Because Jesus said more than once in the scripture, he said, now go and sin no more.
That's
Amen.
Right. That's exactly yeah. what he said. There's quite a few things he said, even in the book of John, you know, that it says that if we repent of our sins, he is a justice. You know what I mean? It says he will cleanse us of our sins and all unrighteousness if we
yes.
repent. And so, yes, it's absolutely necessary to repent, especially for you. And the reason why the enemy wants, there's a new message out there that the Holy Spirit calls greasy grace. And that's you can sin all you want to once you get saved, and it doesn't matter. And the enemy wants that message given because he knows you will have no power over him. You'll have no power whatsoever if you're filled with him and you're helping his marketing, his message, and living his ways. You certainly are not going to have authority and power over him. And he knows that, and so he loves that message right now that's going through the church, even spoken by pastors. And unfortunately, they're actually in deception because the word glory
yes.
talks about what is not going to be allowed in heaven. And so that's why you need to repent. Of course, you can repent anytime you want to. Live a life of repentance if you have to. But, you know, I don't repent because I have nothing to repent of. I'm so filled with Him. I think on things above. I'm living the kingdom, heaven culture. You don't even think about sin. And you become dangerous when you're like that, just like I said before. So these are great days coming on the earth. I'm excited about these days. And I know people want to escape because they don't know who they are. They don't know about the power Christ gave them. And all they can understand is with their natural senses. And yet it says to be carnally minded, that's physically minded, is death. But to be spiritually minded is life. So you're connected with the Holy Spirit. You're walking in the Spirit, obeying God's word, what He has said to do, which is a pleasure. And when you do that, whenever someone says something to me, I always consider it according to the Spirit. And I don't care about any references people have. I want to know them. It says, know no man by the flesh, but know them by the Spirit. So understanding what all that means is so important. It should be basic stuff taught in the church, because Christ taught it to those who were with Him. And so there is a spirit realm around us. God Himself is a spiritual being. Heaven is a spiritual world. You have a spiritual body. And the more you let that spirit man inside of you rule over your flesh, it says that if you walk after the things of the Spirit, you're not going to fulfill the things that your flesh wants, which is to strike back, get angry, be filled with fear. And so it's actually a benefit to learn how to walk in the Spirit. And then you're partnering with the Holy Spirit, and He'll warn you about things. He'll even yell no at me sometimes. And so there's very basic things that the body of Christ needs to know about that aren't necessarily being taught in the church, but I'm certainly going to put them out there. I'm going to have a whole new place on my website that I will add basic stuff for every believer. I'm actually going to create a CD that's called Born Again and give them out to the pastors for free. And when someone gets born again at your church, hand it to them, because it'll have revelation on there how to stay free, what traps the enemy sets, how to make the enemy run from you, how to rule and reign with Christ in this world and become dangerous instead of falling into traps and baits of the enemy, which is what happens to most new believers. Because they're usually handed a Bible and said, here, you know, have a happy life. And, of course, that's not going to happen most of the time because they're unaware of how the enemy operates, you know, how he plots and plans against us. But when you learn and understand who you are, what happens the moment you receive Christ, what happens in that spiritual realm, it is so powerful what happens on the inside of you. And yet most believers are clueless. We are not supposed to tolerate anything of the enemy in our life, in buildings, when we go in buildings, when we walk down the street. We're not supposed to have to tolerate him anywhere around us. And you really can get to that place. I go in buildings now and the demons run. There, it hurts them and it's painful for them to be near me because of the glory and the life and the love of God that's in me. And so there's so many things.
I know that that's true. I know that that's true. I believe that with all of my heart, because, you know, like many of us probably, I don't know, but I read as much as I can about people who, like yourself, that have had, you know, incredibly supernatural ministries and lives, you know, like Lester Summerall and different folks. One of them, a powerful testimony from a pastor who's still alive today. He had mentioned how he went, he was on a particular missions trip, and I guess it was in Fiji or someplace like that, and he was in a hotel, and he went into the hotel, and when he woke up after the first night of sleep, he had these horrible dreams, and it was just, he was so just burdened, you know, like a depression over him, and the Lord said to him, you didn't anoint the room. And he's like, oh. And he went around with holy oil and he anointed the room. He cast the demons out. And now, it's funny, he said after that, he says now wherever he goes, he has a special anointed pillow that he anoints with holy oil and consecrates to Jesus. And he takes that pillow with him wherever he goes, and he always has good dreams about wonderful things. And I'm like, that's awesome.
Yes. And so, but the Father really does want us to have an understanding of the spiritual realm because, number one, He made it. Number two, even though the darkness uses it, it doesn't belong to them. There's a lot that doesn't belong to the enemy. He just gets permission to use it when people on the earth willingly sin, especially if there's areas that are really filled with darkness. And then a lot of people say, well, I went there and I could feel the darkness around me. But now he's given revelation on how to prevent things happening to you even before you leave home. But I can tell you what, right now in heaven, we'll talk about heaven for a little bit. In heaven right now, they are all excited about what the manifested sons and daughters are going to do on the earth. They're excited about the wealth of the wicked being given to the righteous and the just. They're excited about all the new witty ideas and inventions being poured out into the body of Christ. None of them right now up there are planning for the rapture to happen. It's not for right now. And I'm sorry, but God's not allowing a weak, pathetic testimony of the body of Christ to be left on this earth before we're taken out. It says that he's coming for a church without spot, that's sin, and without wrinkle, that's your flesh and your attitude showing up. And it says the world will know us by our love for each other. Those haven't even happened, okay? We're not there yet. I mean, I know the church will get there, but I can tell you God's got some powerful plans for us on this earth. And the spiritual world and spiritual things are going to become more and more aware in this earth, and people are going to start engaging more and more with them. Engaging is a term used in the spirit realm. And right now we're supposed to be engaging with heaven in our life, thinking on things above, engaging with the power of the blood of Christ, engaging with the host of heaven who are waiting to go and do exploits on our behalf because they're sent here to protect us. So heaven is very excited. Unlike a good part of the body who are packing their suitcases, and I always tell people that the Holy Spirit said, unpack and get your crown on because it's time to rule and reign. And so regardless of what everyone's thinking, and again, the blood moons have come and gone, and again, we're all still here, and I tell people, stop wasting your time waiting to escape. Make plans to take God's plan for this time. And we are about to see some powerful beings appear on this earth, the host of heaven. God's going to let them be seen more and more. I see them all the time. You see them even on the news channels now. People have pictures of the angelic in the skies, and even the secular news are putting them on the television, which I said that like 4 or 5 years ago that was going to start happening. But they're going to become more and more clear to people. And the thing they need to understand about the hosts are they are not, I tell them, they're not the pretty boys with a harp, okay? These are fierce beings that look very strange to you, but they're supposed to be fierce because they're the army of heaven. They're not the messengers. They're not the couriers. They're not the ones who bring the body parts from the warehouses in heaven. All of those that I just mentioned are under Gabriel, but the ones under Michael are very different looking, and they were created for one thing, and that was to war. And so if they appeared to you, you probably would think it was, you'd probably call it an alien. I know people who have had encounters with some of the hosts, and they thought at the time that it was an alien. I would say, well, what did they, if they said something, what did they say? And they said, oh, they talked about that God was going to drop things into my spirit so that I could be closer to him. And I went, did you not get a clue that they weren't talking about it, taking you off in a spaceship somewhere, a flying saucer? I said, don't you understand that the hosts are sent here for one reason, and that is to make you, set you on fire, to be flames of fire on behalf of the Father, to be used in these days to push back the evil and the darkness by the way you live your life, by declaring God's will on the earth, and by releasing the host on your behalf to pull down strongholds. It says in
Let me ask you a question. Because this is awesome. This is stuff that is right up our alley. Praise Jesus. So yes. would it be reasonable to suggest that these angelic beings would be perceived as being potentially two different things depending on who you were? In other words, if you were part of the forces of darkness on the earth, you would perceive these as a danger to you, would you not? I mean, these would be beings that would be a threat to your existence
Of course.
Right? I mean, yeah. So okay. So that's what I kind of thought, because we're actually noticing. I'm very fascinated that you're saying this, because we are noticing an influx of new prophecies from folks, and we've been, over the years, we've been pretty choosy about the ones that we put on the top shelf, you know, that we trust, and there's an influx of prophecies warning about what you're talking about. We'll call them angelic beings, otherworldly beings, if you want to, that are about to come upon the earth. And depending, I suppose, on who you are and what your role is on this earth, it could be perceived as, you know, evil angels. Evil angels to the unrighteous are very evil. Evil angels to the righteous are not necessarily... You know what I mean? It's a different perception.
Well, of course, there's both existing on the, you know, that are here all the time. I mean, both sides are here. The darkness and God's beings operate in the spirit realm, which is invisible to the human eye, unless God leaves them open all the time. And then you understand. Now, I can tell you that I can smell evil, not just see it. I can smell it. I even know if I go in a place and it's been there, it has an aroma. There's other dimensions when you begin to operate in the spirit. There are other dimensions that you would have besides just sight. I hear sounds, and there's frequencies. Everyone has a frequency in them, even like flowers have frequencies and other things. God put a frequency in each thing he made. And so the demonic have a whole different frequency and an aroma, a stench. And, I mean, it smells like something that's been dead for a long time. And so I'm fully aware of which side is around me or even where they've been. But there are people who are having encounters with the host, of course, belong to God. Satan has his own army that they all of them actually hate each other. They don't help each other in any way. They're all still ruled by fear, and fear is one of the greatest weapons that they use. But, of course, I'm sure that there are satanic angelic beings encountering with people that want to side with Satan especially. And I've actually had a story given to me. I'll just share it real quick. People who started fooling around with demonic beings just because they thought it was a cool thing. It's a dangerous thing. It's very dangerous because you can't engage or play around with the demonic and not think you're going to be sucked into it. They get a hold, some kind of a control over you the more and more you want to engage with them. And this one couple started just, I mean, literally they would come in and sit down and talk with them and everything. And then they began being harsh to them. And when they were so pulled into what they were involved in, these demonic beings, they couldn't find a way to escape them because they gave permission. When you get permission, you're in trouble if you're given permission to the enemy to have any involvement with you whatsoever. And they actually had created a portal in, it sounds crazy, but they went into the pantry and somehow this portal was created to the underworld, and they would come up and begin to torment them. And someone had to go that was filled with God, and they had to have, the people had to repent of it and loose all that stuff from their soul that they had permitted to be spoken by these demonic beings or anything that they had engaged with them, actually had to sever that control and that hold over them, but especially from their soul, and repent to God. And then this person prayed over them and sealed that portal, that open portal of the underground, and as long as people still gave themselves to God, then they were free of all that. But you don't ever want to play with the darkness, because Satan would love to get a hold of you. Now, anybody can be free, even if people are listening that are involved in that right now. You can be free. The enemy can't just take your soul. Even though he'd like to make you believe he could, he can't. You can be free, and sometimes it's hard to get free if you've been involved in that in a long time. So I'm just, it's a good warning for everybody. Don't play around with darkness. Don't bring images in your home that represent darkness, and you know that it represents darkness. because those also allow openings for the enemy to be invited in your home. You need to put things in there that invite heaven in your home. You can create a habitation for heaven in your home by the things that you declare about God, establish places of prayer in your home, you know, put images that God loves up there and talk about life. Don't talk about death. Don't watch all the doom and gloom that's being put out there. As a matter of fact, if you watch enough of it, you're going to be filled with it, then you're going to want more of it. That's what happens. The more you fill your soul with the darkness, the more it's going to make you choose that stuff. So you need to be filled with the light of God. God says you're a light in this world. You don't want to clutter your spirit with darkness, because then there's gray in there. Because if you mix dark and light, that's gray. And that means you're not going to be fully walking in the light. So there's a lot of people who made up their own assumptions and their own guidelines and perceive what's okay with God and what's not okay with God. But I line up everything with the Word of God. And so if you're not reading the Word, number one, you need to read the Word. You need to be filled with the Word of God. Because when you're filled with the Word of God, the Holy Spirit can come shed light on it, give you revelation on it. And in times of stress or pressure are being put on you, guess what's going to come out of you? Whatever in you is going to come out. Whether it's fear, whether it's anger, or it's offense. But if it's God's Word, then guess what? You're going to start declaring His Word in a time of stress or crisis or something. That scripture is going to start flowing out of your mouth. And angels wait for you to speak the Word of God. It activates them to do things for you. So there's even some people right now saying, we can have spiritual, divine encounters. We don't need the Word of God. That's not what I heard from the Father. His Word is eternal. And it's going to be forever. You go to Word University when you go to heaven. So I don't personally like it when I hear people who are out there doing things that they say they're doing things for God. And if they tell you that the Word of God is not necessary, just pray for them, because His Word is eternal. It's never going to pass away. It's a love letter. It's like it's basic guidelines on how to live your life on the earth. And now that God's bringing revelation on the Word itself, not just revelation about heaven, it shows you how powerful those scriptures are, how powerful they are. It says our weapons are not carnal. That means they're not fleshly weapons like swords and guns and stuff. I'm not against that in a time of war. If some wicked, evil country is coming against us, I am not against us defending ourselves. I just want to put that out there right now. I am not. I believe in our Constitution and our declarations that we have a right to defend ourselves. And that's why America is free right now, because there's countries out there that don't allow anything and they're just ruled by dictators. So I always want to explain myself. But the most powerful weapons that you have as a believer are inside of you as a believer. It's the name of Christ. It's the blood of Christ. It's the host of heaven, because the Word says that your weapons are not carnal. That word carnal means physical. So they're not something of this world. Your weapons are not of this world. Your weapons are not flesh weapons, but they are spiritual, and they are powerful. The Word says they are mighty. These spiritual weapons are mighty. What do? They pull down the strongholds. They are mighty to the pulling down of strongholds. Well, you yourself, as a believer, a flesh believer, you can't go up in that spirit realm and literally fight against the armies of darkness. But one of your weapons is the host of heaven, and they do all the time fight those demonic armies. And you need to understand that they're there to protect us. And so instead of asking God all the time, come on down and do something, when He's already sent them down here to watch over us and protect us, you need to thank the host of heaven for going and pulling down the strongholds around you, your family, your business, the schools. And I just want to put this out for everybody listening. If you have children, you need to teach them, number one, get them born again. I got saved at the age of 4, and I was very aware of what happened to me. I remember the day that I gave my heart to Jesus, and I felt Him coming into me. I knew that I belonged to Him. And if I had been told back then what I know now, a lot of things would be different, but I'm even teaching my grandchildren how to take power over all the power of the enemy, because everybody knows the word says that, but do you know what that means? It's that scripture says, I give you power over all, not some of the time, but all the power of the enemy. And that means in any form or shape, in any being that he has, anything in hell, anything in the second heaven, you as a believer have power over all that power. And then it says, and nothing by any means shall harm you. So if we turn that scripture around, if you turn some scriptures around, you see it clearer. Nothing by any means shall harm me if I take power over all the power of the enemy. And I have walked almost an entire year with no attacks against me. None. Because I've been taking power over all the power of the enemy every day, no matter where I go. And even before I leave, and I loose the host of heaven to pull down the strongholds, no matter where I'm going. And then they are powerless because you have then taken power over them. And if we would teach our children going to the schools, they would never, ever again have another attack on those schools. It would be absolutely impossible to happen. If the children would learn when they were driving in the car on the way to their school, and they say, I, as a child of God, take power over all the power of the enemy to try to come against my school. And I send the host of heaven to pull down all the strongholds in any person who would want to hurt us. Amen. There never again would be an incident like that in a school. We have to take our power over the enemy. And I'm going to broadcast it. I'm going to give me a microphone one day to talk to this world, and it will happen. I'm going to tell them, you need to give yourself to Christ. You need to walk as his earth, because then you can do something about protecting your children. Because we can't be with them all the time. But guess what? Their guardian angels are with them all the time. The army is there waiting for instructions. Because they've been assigned by heaven to come down here and help us and to war for us in this world. If people did it, I've literally been doing it for a year, and I have not been shaken in any way by the enemy in any way whatsoever. And the Father said, it's because I'm ruling. And he said, if my people would take power over all the power of the enemy and loose the host of heaven on them, nothing by any means in any way at any time could harm them.
Amen. Praise God. And you know what? Boy, there's so many testimonies of people that I've been following over the years that have said absolutely similar things. Matter of fact, David Hogan, very, very well known, he was in the battle zone. I mean, this guy goes after the demons down in Mexico in his ministry. And, of course, when you're going after them, I mean, when you're literally going into some of the darkest places on earth, you can expect them to come back at you on the offensive. And he would wake up. It was funny in his testimony. It's amazing how he would wake up in the morning and he would expect one of these things to be in his room. And he would just be like, all right, let's go at it in the name of Jesus. Because this guy was in a constant battle. They would literally go into fasting, 2 days of fasting, 1 day off, 2 days of fasting, 1 day off, because of the powers that they were dealing with. As they were fighting in those areas. Another thing that's fascinating, we just had Pastor Jim Williamson on the show, and Jim used to be, you know, before he went into full-time pastoring and such, he had been a biker, and then and did some after he made Jesus, you know, number one in his life and converted. He had been in a particular facility, a location where there were other bikers, and evidently a person had come in to the facility and started with a baseball bat or some kind of a club and started tearing the place apart, beating it. And all of these big bikers, you know, of course, they're all thinking about, you know, getting their earthly weapons. 2 Corinthians 7:1. I think I have that right. Yep. Weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds.
Yes.
Okay. And so what Jim did is he went over to the guy from a godly standpoint. Here's this guy wielding a club that could kill him with one swing of the club. And he said to the guy, in the name of Jesus, I come against you. Now, he was talking to the demon that was affecting the guy. He talked to the demon, and he said, in the name of Jesus, I come against you. And the guy dropped the club and ran out of the building. We have testimony after testimony after testimony. Henry Groover, another testimony, was being held with a – they were going to kill him. Hezbollah, Hezbollah, a terrorist, had him inside of a small cave out – I don't remember what country it was, but they had him with their arm – they were strangling him, and they were going to kill him. And the Lord said to him spiritually while he was – just before the throw of death, just before the guy stuck a knife in his neck, the Lord said, Henry, speak to him, or speak in the spirit to me. Say, Father, forgive him, for he knows not what he does. He told, the Lord told him not to move his lips, but to spiritually pray, Father, forgive him, for he knows not what he does. When Henry silently prayed that prayer, it diffused the power of the demons that were controlling the Hezbollah terrorist. They dropped the knife and let him leave, and he lived.
That's because when the power of darkness is stripped away from individuals, fear falls on them because they're no longer have the boldness of that demonic controlling them. It's gone. And then they're left there on their own, and fear falls on them. 90% of the time, fear falls on them, and they'll let people go, or they'll run themselves because they're now powerless. And so, yes, that does work. And by the way, I have spoken many times in my spirit. I know exactly what you're talking about. Your spirit has a voice. You don't hear it, but all of heaven hears it, and the demonic hears it. And so I do understand about speaking in your spirit, so I totally understand about the Father saying that to him. But yes, when you strip away the power of the enemy controlling these gangs and these terrorists and these other people, they are left totally on their own. And the only reason why they've been so terrible and so evil is because they're controlled by the demonic. And when that is removed from them, fear falls on them because that boldness and that power leaves them. And all of a sudden, there's nothing in them that can tell them what to do or to control them. And so that's what happens in the spirit realm. That's exactly what's happening. And that's what I meant about children praying over their school. And because then the demonic that are there are rendered powerless to use people to come in there. And so that's exactly what's happened. I've heard the same thing happen. An awesome testimony about a pastor in, I think it was Nigeria, and his mother was kidnapped. And she's a powerful woman of God. And he really wasn't that concerned because he knew his mother. I mean, that's why he was like that. He actually speaks and mountains open and they swallow satanic altars in front of people. If you're going to go to those countries like that, you better be filled with God. You better know about your power and authority. So anyway, these kidnappers had her, and the congregation was saying, should we raise money? These people were holding her for ransom. And the pastor, who was their son, he said, I will not pay them one penny. I will not pay them one penny of ransom. They said, well, I don't have to ransom her. Her father and my father will rescue her. And so, meanwhile, back at the place where they were holding her, she was just causing a mess to go on. And what they would do, this is exactly what these kidnappers did in this country. They had evil spirits in these sacred, they called them sacred, pots where the demons would live because they gave them permission to come there. And what they would do, they would conjure the spirits up and they wanted them to enter them so they would be bold enough to go out and kidnap the people, and they would hold them for ransom. Then they would collect the ransom. And they did it to the Christians. They were targeting the Christians because they knew that they would pay for their family members. And so they made a mistake picking the one they picked. It was a big mistake. And she saw this going on. She testified about it later, what happened in there. But the evil spirits were coming up out of these jars, had their backs to her. And all of a sudden she yells, fire, 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 fire. And they turned around and had the most horrified look on their face and started screaming. And they went back in those jars, and they wouldn't come back out while she was there.
Wow.
And the kidnappers started yelling, "What have you done to our business?" How about, this is what they said, these are humans. "What have you done to our business? We need them. We need their power to go and do this business." And she said, "You'll have no business while you keep me here."
Uh-huh.
And so they kept sending ransom notes, and the pastor kept saying, you need to bring my mother back. I'll be waiting at such and such a place. You'll bring her back, or you will just suffer pain." And so 2 or 3 days had gone by, and they had no business. Those evil spirits would not come out of those jars while this woman of God, a grandmother, while she was there operating in the power that God gave her, knowing who she was. And finally they said, "Well, if you don't stop doing this, then we're going to kill you." And she said, "Well, you're not going to be able to kill me because my father will protect me." And then she started yelling, "Fire, fire, fire," at them. And they started burning, and they were screaming because they were burning, because this woman who knew she was using the power of God. And they started screaming and yelling, and they started yelling, "We have to get rid of her, we have to get rid of her."
Yes.
And so finally, guess what? They gave her back.
Yes. You know what? That's
they
amazing.
They gave her back to the pastor, and the pastor said, "I was not afraid for you, Mom, because I knew what you were doing to them. I knew you would torment them. I knew that you would stop their activities." And they never came near that church again. They never came near any of the people because they knew that they walked in true power and authority through the blood of Jesus Christ. So
Amen.
You do have power over the enemy. But I hear all kinds of encounters like that, too, of people standing up and speaking against the evil, because it says if you resist him, resisting is not just sitting in a corner somewhere. It says if you submit yourself to God and put yourself under him and you resist the devil, it says he will flee.
Right.
So, I mean, there's just in the word by itself, it shows you ways to come against that. But we do need to be aware of it. But like I said, heaven is celebrating over this time on the earth. They're preparing to send out some of the greatest miraculous things about to happen on this earth. I mean, supernatural miraculous things. And I'm so glad that the internet's there, because nobody can stop you from recording those things when they start happening and putting them on the internet, and they'll go viral around this world.
Yep.
So we're living in an amazing time on this earth.
You know, amen. And just to share with you a confirmation to that burning, burning, burning thing, I received an email from a lady. Now, you know about this. I know you're aware of this because you just said you were. And it's pretty obvious for people who are in tune with the supernatural power of God and the manifestation of it all across the world. But this particular lady lives in South Africa. And she emails me, you know, off and on. And God bless her. We had a conversation over Skype for a while, but she lives a very supernatural life, and has some really powerful testimonies. And if you do live in those kinds of places, you know, parts of Africa especially, there are other places in the world that are very much like this, where there's a lot of darkness, a lot of that pervasive. It's a pervasive
mm-hmm.
darkness. Witchcraft, shamanism is a way of life. These people are born, you know, just like some of the cultures in the Caribbean. They're born in places where voodoo and black magic and stuff is practiced from the time they're a little child, so they're used to
the supernatural. Yeah, and they're raised that it's really real. They're raised up that this stuff is real.
And that's why they
have so they know it is.
Yeah, and they have such wonderful faith, because unlike the developed countries where we're scolded and sent to insane asylums the second we say something supernatural happened, they live in cultures where supernatural is normal. So when they hear about Jesus, their faith is phenomenal. But this
mm-hmm.
lady from South America, this is so amazing. She sent me a message, an email, because we were doing a prayer vigil show and casting demons out and such like that as part of the prayer vigil show. And she told me that I was so surprised. I was like, wow, because, you know, you don't know when you're doing internet-based radio ministry work and praying, unless somebody emails you with a testimony, you have no idea. You're working in 100% faith because you're not
mm-hmm.
standing in front of people, right? She
mm-hmm.
sends me an email. Praise God. I just cried. She sends me an email and she said, "I was playing your prayer vigil show on the computer downstairs," and she said, because there's a lot of people who practice black magic there, and there's a guy, a man, I guess, who lived in the apartment above her.
Mm-hmm.
And she said, while the the casting of demons and such like that was going on in the prayer vigil show, she mm-hmm. said the man started running around, thumping and running all around his apartment upstairs, screaming, "I'm burning! I'm burning! I'm burning!" And then she went and preached the next day. She went and told him about Jesus, and so she's mm-hmm. still working on him. But isn't that just amazing, the power of God?
Oh, yeah. Oh, because things travel through the spirit realm. You don't physically have to be in certain places even. If you declare over different areas and things like that, there's it's not like in this time-space world that we are so connected to, that you can actually pray for people in specific areas like overseas and stuff like that, and you can actually send like the life of God and the power of God and peace. You can send them through the spirit realm. You can declare, "I send this." Christ actually did that, you know, even in the Word when he told the centurion, if you go back, you find out that they're healed. He sent that healing there. He sent it before the centurion went back. And when he went back, there they were. They were made whole. So there's many things. That's why it's important to understand the operations in the spirit. Prayer itself is a spiritual weapon. So we have powerful weapons, but people so much give themselves to the world today and love the things of the world. They don't save time in their life for Christ or the Word or even prayer. I loved the movie War Room. I don't know if you got to see it, if you haven't seen it yet. I loved that movie. I actually went back 4 times and took people with me.
Wow.
And we have an encounter room. We've had an encounter room for a long time with those open portals of heaven. And then the Father told me, "I want you to make a war wall." And so I got this beautiful fabric and put the fabric on the wall, and I started putting people's pictures and like crowns and decorations for the kingdom age. All of my family's up there. And when we get specific requests from friends around the world, we put there and we declare over them. So you can create a war wall. Just find an empty room. Someone used the inside of a closet door, and actually this grandmother in the movie, you would love her. She's very funny, too. The movie's funny, but it's powerful, and it shows truth about prayer. I encourage anybody, if you haven't seen War Room, you need to go and see it. And the funny thing was, through the whole movie, people were making comments that were sitting there, especially prayer warriors. They were saying, "Amen, that's right. You go, God." And I started just declaring right along with them every time I saw it. So you actually had interaction with the people sitting in the theater agreeing with what was going on in the movie. And just you see the power of prayer. You see the evidence of the power of prayer. And someone actually opened the door of their house in the movie and evicted the devil and all of his stuff out of their house, which is what I tell people to do all the time. So it's a really good – it'll get you excited about prayer. It'll even activate you and show you how you can start having a deeper prayer life. And let me tell you, God loves it when you put an action to your words. And he loves it when you write things down. It establishes stuff in heaven when you write it down. That's what he said back in the, you know, back in the ancient days when he told people to write it on the walls, on the doors of your home, and write this here and write that. You know, it means something when you write something down. And that's what this woman did. She'd write down prayers. She'd write down scriptures that would answer those prayers, and she'd put them side by side and go in there every day and just declare over them. And so it's a wonderful movie. It will connect you to an awesome prayer life. And I loved that movie. And there's not a whole lot of them I love, but I actually love that movie. So go see it.
Wow, that's so awesome. A friend of mine, he's a trucker, and he called me the other day. It was, I don't know, some part of the country, and he's like, "Have you seen that movie yet? Have you seen that movie yet?" And he's like, "You got to go see it." He said, "When we came out of the theater, the people were so on fire that we almost had a prayer meeting right in the middle of the theater." I was like, "Oh, my gosh." He's like, he couldn't believe it. Oh, that's just an awesome blessing.
They have had people healed outside in the halls of the theater. Everybody was outside talking about it. All the people that were in the movie, the theater, the staff running the theaters don't know what to do with it. They don't know what to do with it. And they actually had like a black congregation and a white congregation in the same theater. When they came out the hallway, they started repenting to each other and hugging each other. This is right in the middle while people are walking around trying to get to their other movies. And so it definitely had a life-changing impact on people. And I wanted to start a whole sermon, but I didn't do it.
I know. I'm a little bit afraid to go myself because I can ask anybody who's a regular listener of this show. When I get preached, I can see
you
myself
have
jumping
a service
up in the
out in the hallway.
Oh, yeah, they would be dragging me out. They'd be like, "Call the police! That guy's a crazy person."
Well, actually, the people that came that were so excited sitting down, they had to sit down because this is the thing that happens is your soul is filled with the power and the life of God during the movie. It's not just something you're seeing. It's something that's going in your soul. And so when you don't want to leave, you don't want to leave. It's like going to a really powerful revival service. You don't want to leave. So everybody wants to stand in the hallways and talk. Then they go outside and talk. And one time I went to see my friend in Atlanta. She's one of our staff members that lives up there. And we all went together. And let me tell you, we had service outside the church, outside the theater after that happened, and there was so many people out there talking. And I came out of the theater to the people in the hallway, and I said, "You know what? It's about time that we got our crowns on and started ruling and reigning in this kingdom age." And I walked outside, and they all followed me outside and started saying, "What are you talking about? What is this kingdom age? What do you know? What do you know about putting your crown on? What is this about ruling?" So we like had a meeting outside. And so it can start awesome conversations, and sometimes even the staff of the theater will ask you, "What did you think about that movie?" Because they don't know what to do about, I mean, some theaters have had mass healings. Even non-believers who were in the hallways got healed because of the presence of God. So I would say yes, make sure you go see it.
Wow, that's awesome. I'm down. I'll just have to, I don't know, I'll just have to just say, "Dear Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, keep me calm. Keep me calm." In the name of Jesus, keep me out of jail, Lord. Keep me out of jail.
Well, it's wonderful to see them in the secular theaters, and there's so much of God, even the ones that weren't quite, you know, maybe they embellished them. There's been so much of God in the theaters over the last 12 months. More than there has been in 10 years. It's just, and there's more coming out because while you watch that movie, the commercials, you know, they show coming, the previews of coming movies, they're all about movies that are about to be put in the theaters about God. Things that, either about heaven or the power of God or, you know, one of the disciples or somebody. Hollywood has realized that there is a hunger for these movies. And which I prophesied like 4 years ago, I said that God was going to take over Hollywood, and he has, and he's not done because I am meeting with three different producers and some script writers to give them scripts about the spirit realm, and they are going wild. So there will be some new movies out there in the next couple years that I'm going to write, not just write the scripts for them, but I'm going to give them images to put in the movie. Spiritual beings will be in the movie.
Wow, praise God. And you know, I want to keep my promises to the listeners, and some people are sending in some emails, and I wanted to
Let's do some Q&A.
Yeah, amen. So a fellow by the name of Dylan says, how does God handle someone who dies but has never heard the gospel or anything about Jesus or anything, and they just pass away? How does the Lord handle that?
Well, first of all, the Word says, it says in the Word of God, that I make myself known to every man. And there are people that maybe didn't understand who God was, but in their heart that they know there is a God and that there is someone who created them. And they really want to know him. There is a slim veil of There's a slim veil, I don't even want to call it time, but there's a slim veil of space that right before you actually are dead, that many times Christ, only because I know him, he will appear to people and reveal himself to them. And I know the first time I was taken to heaven, he told me that. And so I encourage people, never stop praying for your family members, those that you think of as family. When it says you and your household shall be saved, you know, God gives us promises because we belong to him, that there will be a way that he can, you know. And I remind people, he has the keys. People don't think about those keys. Why do you think he, like I explained earlier, he went to the cross to pay the price for us to be saved, to become righteous, but there was a reason why he entered into hell. Why did God do that? Why didn't he just take his son home if it was all finished on the cross? And why didn't he take him home then? He didn't. He was 3 days down there. And they, of course, God knew he was going to bushwhack the enemy. And, of course, on the third day, and Christ said nothing until at that moment when the Father moved on him because he was totally separated from him, but he had already had the plan. Christ knew when he went into hell what would happen. He knew that. He still had to experience all of the, you know, the torment and the pain on the cross, and even before the cross, he had to still be willing to take his Father's plan. But God had already showed him what would happen. And still, you know, you think, well, that makes it better. You still have to walk through it. He still had to be willing. And it wasn't even the pain of the cross that was the greatest sacrifice. That was the lesser sacrifice. The greater sacrifice was drinking that cup. It was a spiritual cup that he drank in the garden that was all the sins of the world. He had to take them on his holy body. And that's why sin was crucified on the cross with Christ. That's why his blood is the only way to get into heaven, because he took that on himself. That was more painful than actually hanging on the cross. So he had to go through all of that, knowing, you know, on the third day, even though he was totally separated from his Father, it was the worst part of him out of all that he did was being separated from his Father. But on the morning of the third day, there was a shout from heaven, and he stood up, and then Christ spoke. And then he began to melt the faces of the hierarchy of hell, and he took power over all the power of the enemy in their own headquarters, in front of their leader. Then he stripped everything off of Satan, including all the beautiful gemstones the Father had put on him, according to Ezekiel 28. He took everything away from him, and then the last most humiliating thing he did was he took those keys away from Satan of death, hell, and the grave. And there is a thin veil there before actual death takes place in the spirit realm around every person. You know, it says man is appointed unto once to die and then the judgment, and everybody thinks that that's talking about the great white throne judgment, when at the end of time, when all the wicked dead will be taken out of hell and they'll stand before the throne of God, the judgment, the white, great white throne judgment. But that's not what that's talking about. It says it's appointed unto man once to die and then the judgment. Well, what is that judgment that takes place at death? Do you have the right to enter into heaven, or are you going to hell? And there's a thin veil of I don't know how I can express that. I can't express that to you. I have to say a space more than time. There's a space before you're actually dead. Even as you're, like, your spirit, there's a time when your spirit steps out of your body, but it's a process of coming out of your body, that if someone is praying for that person, I know Christ appears to them and offers himself to them. So that's,
you know,
why it's important. Yes.
Well, here's something to support what you're saying. That veil or area or realm that is in the interim was experienced by Pastor Howard Pittman. Also,
oh, I know about him.
Yeah,
and
we had him on
too,
the show.
Another guy. Several people actually
and
have experienced it.
Sarah Minet, when she committed suicide, the Lord spared her, and she was in a similar realm. She was not allowed to enter into actual heaven, but she was in a special realm area, and she learned a lot while she was there. It was very powerful.
Mm-hmm.
And also, there's a scripture that a sister that's been helping us out with this ministry awful lot, God bless her, Sister Nancy, sent to me, I was like, you got to be kidding me. My mouth just hit the ground. Job 22 verse 30, it says, and this is one of those that just skips you just could read it 50 times, you don't see it, and then you're like, oh my gosh. It says, Job 22, verse 30, it says, and I think this is out of the Amplified, it says, he, it's referring to the Father, he will even deliver the one for whom you intercede, who is not innocent. Yes, he will be delivered through the cleanness of your hands.
Your hands, that's right.
Wow.
That's right.
And I have a testimony. There's a guy, I don't have his name, and I'm sorry because I just, you know, I'm just not prepared. Just wasn't prepared for this. But there's a man, he's now a pastor. He was on Sid Rossett Supernatural. This is amazing, folks, because this defies the basic fundamental understanding of the bulk of Christianity regarding death, prayer, hell, and heaven. It completely defies it. We were basically trained just because of doctrine
you're
of
right.
men, that mm-hmm. you die, and at that very split second of time, you go straight to hell or you go straight to heaven. But what's fascinating is there's a man, if you want, you can email me, and I'll give you a link to his testimony. Just email me at jbaptist777@gmail.com, and I'll send you his testimony. But this man was, at the age of 8 or 9 years old, was a murderer and a very powerful drug dealer, believe it or not, at the age of 9. Very feared. He got involved in a drug deal, and was shot and killed, and he was sent to hell. He was in hell, and he was burning in hell. Let me make that clear. He was in hell. Now, in the meantime, his mother, who did not know that he was killed, was on her knees. She did not know that he was in hell. And she, as she did every single day, was on her knees crying out to the Lord, praying for her drug dealer murderous son. Father, please, Father, seeking him from fervently mm-hmm. seeking the Father, as she had
the
every single day.
Effectual fervent prayer.
Yeah, effectual fervent for James 5:16b. Amen.
Yes.
And
yes.
And guess what? The Father took the burning little boy out of hell and raised him from the dead and
mm-hmm.
brought him back to life. And he became a full-time pastor in the ministry and mm-hmm. gave his testimony on Sid Ross. So there's a mm-hmm. there's an account whereby the individual had been sent to hell. But
mm-hmm.
the prayers of
Ian
the mother
was the same
got
way,
him
I think. The one that was the guy that was stung by the jellyfish and died and was in hell, and then he remembered about his mom praying and everything, and all he yelled was the name of Jesus, and this brilliant light comes down into hell, and Christ reached down in there and took him out. And that's when he took him up to that place you were talking about, and he showed him his mother praying and said,
wow.
I have to. He said, I cannot let my words drop to the ground, and because of her, and he actually saw his mom, who was also praying at that time, he said, because of her prayers and what she's done with her life, I have to be faithful that her and her household will be saved. And because she is pure and she is holy and she's crying out, he said, I have to offer myself to you. Do you want me? And I'm telling you, the power of God came on him. He has an awesome testimony too. And he stood and began to weep, knowing that he was not worthy, and he even started telling him, I'm not worthy of even standing in your presence. And then waves of love began to consume him. And he said, but I have to give you a chance because of your mother. And of course, then he
wow.
did receive him. And once again, he also, when he came to, he was on the in the mortuary with a tag on his toe and sat up and freaked out all the doctors, and he went and found clothes to put on and went out, and he said, I have to let my mother know. And so I also do know of accounts, which you have to remember, he has the keys. He has keys. One of them has hell on it. Now, I personally don't believe he can go get someone who's been there for months or years or stuff like that, or everybody be doing it. But
right,
I think
right.
at that time, at that window of time, that's there, and you know, usually it's like 3 days before they actually bury you, and all kinds of things could be happening in the spirit realm that we don't know of. So don't ever stop praying for your family members. And I will also mention this, because I have to, there are people that he's done that with and gave them a choice, actually gave Ian a choice, do you want to come with me? And he moved and he could actually see up into heaven, do you want to come with me? And he started to go and he said no, because if I go, my mother will never know that you brought me back and gave me a chance. And that's why he went back to earth. But
oh,
sometimes,
wow.
sometimes people go when they're given a choice at that time, if he's rescued them because of our prayers and they've accepted him, he many times will say, do you want to go or you want to stay? A lot of people cannot resist that love and that power and that life of God that they feel, and they go with him. And that's why Christ said many people will be surprised who made it because of their prayers. So, yeah, I think that's awesome. But there was a reason why he went down there, and one of those was so he could get those keys of hell, death, and the grave. And
that's so
one time
awesome.
I'll probably do a revelation on that. But
yeah, Maurice Clark.
Another question. This is why it takes so long to answer questions.
I know, but it's so awesome. Maurice Clark.
We'll have to do another that we do absolutely nothing but Q&A.
I would love to do another show. I would love to. I'll get with I forget what her name is. I'm sorry.
Margaret.
I'll get with her again. We'll line up another one because it's just so exciting.
Sure,
Maurice
I can
Clark.
Always do them at night, especially.
Oh, praise Jesus. Yeah, Maurice Clark, when he was in heaven, he actually had a guy come up to him. I guess he was standing across a hill or across a river from him, and he was shouting across the river, going, "Brother Clark, I would not be in heaven if it wasn't for your prayers."
That's
we don't realize how significant this is.
No, we don't. It's
Val,
powerful.
Sorry about this, Val. I'm trying to be faithful to the question.
I know.
I know people are blessed because they send in emails and like, thank you for talking about that. Val says, if we were in heaven before we came to earth, why can't we remember it? That was the first half. That'll be the A question. And the B question is, what is your favorite place in heaven?
So the A question is, why don't we remember being there?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that memory is taken from us. It's just taken from us so that God can be fair with every person. Every person has to choose. That's why he gave us a will. He didn't want us to be a bunch of robots. And so I've only met a couple people that, for whatever reason, actually remembered sitting in God's hand as a little spirit being of light. They remember sitting in his hand. And they said, why do I keep, they didn't know why they kept having that. They never heard me talk about us living in God and, you know, him actually being a real father to us at that time. And I said, you're remembering, it's rare, but you're remembering where you were before you came here. And so I now, since, of course, I've been with the Father all these times, I have many visions of me many times being with him, and I will just throw this out there for free. At this time on the earth, he's beginning to connect people that were friends when we lived in God. We were little individual people, and we played like little children, and he would tell us stories and share about things to come, and he actually shared some about our life on the earth before he sent us down here. But he's connecting people back together again that actually play together inside of him for these purposes during the kingdom age. And I have met people that I knew that I knew that I knew them then, but I didn't know until I met them. So he's taken it from us because he's going to give everybody a choice, just like Adam and Eve had a choice. He gave them, he said, you have all, they could have had anything in the garden, but don't go there. But they had to have a choice. And by the way, the angels had to do the same thing. All of the angels, every angel in heaven had to choose if they were going to believe Lucifer's lie and go with him or stay with God. And so everything has had to choose. Every being has had to choose. Are they going to remain faithful to God and stay with him? Those angels only chose once because they live with God. They can't ever repent. He's not taking all the demons to heaven. He's not taking Lucifer to heaven. And there's someone actually preaching that now. They said every person on the earth will go to heaven. Even Lucifer will be forgiven and the demons. That is not going to happen. It says clearly in the word what will happen to them. But and B, it has to be... It has to be, well, I love, there's so many places in heaven, that's a hard question. I absolutely love being with the Father. And guess what? So does Jesus. He talked about him nonstop in the Word. And he gets to walk every person back up the throne and give them back to the Father. That was his prize for going to the cross, that he could take us back He's the only way back. He's the only door. He's the only way back to the Father, which is literal, because when you come to heaven, he walks you up those steps to that throne. I love being with the Father. I love being sitting at his feet at the throne or somewhere in heaven. By the way, God is not super glued to the throne. The Father is not super glued to the throne. He can go around heaven and be with people. He's got a throne inside. He's got one outside. People have been caught up to both places. He has a commissioning throne room that's different from the great throne room. He has there's a intercessory place even in heaven that people can go and declare things. And when it talks about the souls under the altar, which a lot of people couldn't picture that, the souls are just believers who died and went to heaven. And there's a room. The throne is so huge, it's almost like a structure itself. There's a room under the throne that many believers will go in there, or groups will go in there and declare things to God. That's why the souls could be under the altar crying out. You know, in the book of Revelation, I believe it talks about them. They go, how could they do that, crawl under an altar? No, it's because there's a whole massive room underneath the throne, and so people will go in there and declare things. They pray all over heaven for you. But anyway, that's an answer to your question. So I love to be in the throne room, especially when the Father's there. I love being with him. I know that's where I came
I just
from.
Knew
I
it.
Love
I
Jesus,
just...
too.
Oh, no, yeah, amen. Now, I used to think, like, because there's, I forget what scripture it is, but there's one in Revelation. It's talking about the tribulation saints or whatever, and it's
yes.
saying something about, it says
yes.
that when they come out, that they will spend, you know, pretty much all of eternity in the throne room of God. And I was like, well, that's kind of, that would be kind of boring. And then I thought, then I had a rethought. I was like, no, it's like got to be the opposite. It's the opposite. It's got to be like the coolest thing ever.
It will be. People celebrate. They throw celebration parties. They do amazing things. I mean, things they've never told anybody. Sometimes you'll take everyone in the throne room somewhere into the future.
Wow. Ooh,
like sometimes
ooh.
They like he'll show them the new earth. You see all kinds of things when you go to heaven. You don't
know. There's we got a new earth and a new okay I got oh no now this is getting great because new earth we got a new earth and a new heavens question we got what will we be doing for all of eternity question but real quick I want to throw one in there because this is so exciting so Jesus and so this kind of is part of the question that Scott asked about all of eternity so Jesus you know created ultimately with the Father everything.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
all of outer space, all of the galaxies and planets and all
mm-hmm.
that amazing stuff and the nebulas and the quasars and all that stuff. And I'm like, you know, is there an opportunity for us to like, I don't know, tour around, cruise around and see some of that stuff? I mean, is that part of, do you think, down the road, maybe in eternity? I mean, how do you perceive that all fitting into the realm of ruling and reigning with Jesus?
Because we will be going to the other planets and the galaxies.
Well, cool.
One of the things...
I just watched that movie, Contact, with Jodie Foster, and I cannot help to see the fingerprint of God all over these movies. It's amazing.
Yeah.
In that
yeah.
movie... She has this epiphany at the end when she's being queried by the Senate subcommittee about
mm-hmm.
her event that took 18 minutes where she was traveling through this wormhole and seeing all of God's creation.
Mm-hmm.
And the funny thing about it was the senator said, do you expect us to take this all on faith? And she looks, and she's got tears coming out of her eyes because she doesn't believe in faith, and she just realized that she had to believe in faith in order
That's
to believe
right.
what she's. How awesome!
That's right. Yes, actually, what we get to, I can actually tell you what we get to do because he took me forward and showed me. I've had glimpses of the new earth, but I've also had glimpses of what will be out and around that new earth, and. Actually know names of some of the planets. One is going to be called Aquatica, and that world will be almost all water. And people who love water sports and be with the dolphins and the whales and they'll get to visit that place, and there'll be there's little strips of land on it, but it's mostly water for people who love that kind of stuff. So what this is, instead of on the earth, we go to places like for vacation, exciting things we want to see and do. Well, instead of you being held to one world, you have the whole galaxy to visit. And not only will you visit it, but like our Father, who is the great creator, we have creativity on the inside of us. Otherwise, we couldn't say, call those things to be not as though they were. That is a form of creativity. You're creating your life atmosphere around you right now by declaring things around your life. Now, you have to have that heart of humility with God. You can't just say, I want to create riches and wealth to come to me because I want to be wealthy. I'm not talking about that type of thing, but we will be actually like given a planet and said, what fun place or exciting place can you make here for people to go and visit?
Wow. You know,
You will speak it. The one thing we will not ever make, and I'm also got to, he always makes me make things perfectly clear, we are not going to create new races of people to rule over. You don't want it. I don't want it. We don't want it. I would never want to be God, but because he is a great creator, he wants us to create like plants and trees and structures and fun, exciting things to do. And if you're already there in that place with God, you're probably going ballistic right now because he made us to be able to think and create and use gifts that he put in us. And he is our Father who made everything. He thought it. He willed it. The word stepped out of him and made it. Okay, so we'll be creating basically with our Father to do things, but we decide, and this is what the word says. God said it, he saw it, and if he liked it, it remained. And if he didn't like it, it didn't remain. So don't worry about making things that aren't. And this is the one thing. We can't create evil. There will be no evil in that time. When that time's there, all evil, all wickedness, all selfishness will not even exist. It won't exist anywhere where we go. It won't ever be on the new earth. It's not going to be in heaven. It'll be gone forever in the lake of fire. So you will create only beautiful, wonderful, amazing, exciting things. And we literally will go. We can go on ships because people like to do that. But you can just go by yourself and your glorified body to visit these amazing places. And so one day they're like a canvas for us to create on.
Wow, you know, that's amazing. There's so many testimonies of people that like there was a testimony of a girl. I think it was Lisa or maybe her name was Erin. I forget which one. And I mentioned this on another show. And she was in the presence of the Lord, she said, I knew that I would be able to travel through the heavens and outer space and see things, and that some wouldn't, but it was a reward that I had been given for something. And mm-hmm. I was like, oh, wow. And then there was another testimony of another person that had been taken to hell in heaven that had said that he was shown that Jesus showed him a whole bunch of different. He asked Jesus, you know, I'm not a real big fan of the word alien because by definition, even Jesus is an alien. You know what I mean? Anything that's
not.
We
are too. We're not.
I know.
World.
We're sojourners. I know. We're not from this world. We're all
aliens. We're the
aliens.
I tell people that all the time.
Exactly. Isn't that the truth, right? But he went. You know, he had died, and he got to meet Jesus when he was taken up to heaven, and he asked Jesus about aliens. And, you know, is there life on other planets is what he said. And Jesus said, oh, yes, there's a lot of life on other planets. And he brought them out. He said, would you like to see some? And he's like, yeah, yeah. And he showed them all these different types of beings and things. He said in the beginning, most of them were, you know, like us, you know, kind of like humanoid-ish. And then he said, but then they became more unusual, you know, looking. And then after a while, they became so kind of weird looking that he said, okay, I've seen enough. I don't need to see any more. And then Jesus had told him that some of the beings even had the ability to create. And so I was like, when I heard that, I was like, no way. And you just confirmed it. Praise Jesus. That's awesome.
Well, yeah, the thing is this, that God still made all of them, because there aren't, like, when people say the word alien, they think there's another life force or there's other beings that are also like gods out there. But God made everything that ever existed. So he did, they're probably spiritual beings, and he does position them on different, not a lot of people know about this either, but, you know, I will, all this stuff I'll eventually talk about, but he does have spiritual beings that are put on different places, planets and stuff out there, even some of the stars, the bigger stars and stuff like that. He does have, like, bases everywhere, and yes, they do speak, and they can make things, whatever God allows them to do. And so there's whole worlds of stuff that people right now relate to heaven, earth, and hell, but that's not all he made. I mean, he did make the universe. And I actually like to use the word cosmos, and some people may not know this, but when we talk about the universe, a lot of people say the universe was made by the Big Bang Theory, but when you use the word cosmos in the dictionary, it was made by intelligent design by a creator. So I like to use Shamayim. The word cosmos. A lot of people don't know that. And I forgot who, somewhere in, I don't know if it was Congress or somewhere, wanted to stop using that word, like in schools. I mean, they're going to try to wipe everything they got out of the can, because when they realized that's what that meant, they didn't want that in the science classes. They literally didn't want the word cosmos used, because it says done by life by intelligent design and by a creator. An individual creator. So I like the word cosmos. So
I
on the cosmos,
too.
There's many things and many places God has made. Of course, I think I've shared before that there's a place in heaven that's this massive arch door, and it says the observatory when you go in, and all it is this massive door, and when you open it, you're out in outer space.
Oh, wow. I am totally hanging out there. Hey, everybody, come and say hi to me. I'll be right by that door.
You'll be in the observatory.
Oh yeah, you can believe that. Praise Jesus. Oh yeah. Heather says, I know I feel bad sometimes, but anyway, Heather says, do we all speak? Oh, and by the way, hello, Heather. I love your sheepies, and you can send them to Florida to visit me anytime you want. She has the cutest sheep. They're so cute. But anyway, do we all speak one language in heaven? How does the language barrier thing go away there?
Well, I can tell you that I'm always going to take you back to the Word. It says in the Word that every tongue, tribe, and nation is represented in heaven, will be represented in heaven. People still speak in their own language whenever they want to. There is a heavenly language. There's also another language that is the language of the angels. They have their own language, separate from humans when believers when they die and go to heaven. Everybody can still speak in their own dialect. When I was there, it did not matter what language someone spoke in, I understood it. So we don't have that barrier. That barrier is totally removed. Everybody understands everybody, no matter what language they're speaking in, once you go there and move there. Now, some people who are caught up for a visit and brought back, sometimes they'll say, I heard someone talking in this language I didn't understand. But when you go there, when you die and you're going to move to heaven and live there, you will understand everybody. But there is definitely, there is a heavenly language that I heard people speaking in the heavenly language, and I didn't understand them because I wasn't a resident. And then I heard them singing in it, and it was powerful, and it was beautiful, and it was majestic. So there's all kinds of tongues and languages in heaven. People can still speak in tongues. They can go into the their intercessory place they have there that's off of the throne room. There's many, many hallways leading off the throne room. There's many rooms in the throne room area that go to different places in heaven. But, you know, language, if anything, it's increased. It's not like everybody now speaks one thing. there is a heavenly language that everybody can speak in and sing in, and those doing that can understand it. But me, because I wasn't, it was the only language I didn't understand. Well, I didn't understand the angels' language unless they spoke like English, then I could understand them. But the heavenly language, there is a heavenly language that unifies everybody in heaven, and I've heard them sing it at one time, and you could hear it all over the world. The beautiful world, the Father's house is a world. I could hear that sound and that song everywhere, but I didn't understand it, but it was beautiful.
Wow, that's awesome. Praise God. TH says, I'm going to toss two over the wall to you real quick. TH says, how do we prepare to receive a powerful anointing? He's talking about the manifestation of the Holy Spirit upon, you know, the sons of God. How do we prepare ourselves? And then Jeannie says, and what about, this one I find very interesting, what about free will in heaven?
Okay, well, your soul's not ever, by the way, people who think that we of course, made in three parts, body, soul, and spirit. Your soul and your spirit are spiritual things. Your soul's a spiritual thing. Your soul actually lives in your spirit. There's no life without the spirit. So you were a spiritual being before you moved here. Before you moved here, you had a soul, but you didn't really need to use it because God, you lived in him. And you moved in and out of him, and he was your supply of everything. But when Adam was made on the earth, and he said he became a living soul, then at that time he was accountable. You know, he was made an adult at the time. So your soul will always stay with your spirit. They're not going to be separated. Your flesh, of course, your body is separated at the time of death. Or if you have what people call that's why they say out-of-body experiences. If you're caught up by God, by your spiritual body, your soul is in that spirit. So if your will is a part of your soul is your will, your mind, and your emotions, you will always have that. But there's no sin. There's not even a chance that you could think about sin. There's no sin, no hate, no selfishness, no coveting. None of that will exist for all eternity. It's not in your soul or the ability to have it. So, of course, you can choose in heaven where you want to go. You can choose with your will. I want to go see the Father. I'm going to the Crystal Sea. I'm going to go see members of my family. I'm going to go meet Elijah. I want to see the new sky mansions. I want to swim under the Crystal Sea. I want to walk on the rainbow bridges. I want to go to the Hall of Knowledge. I want to go to the Valley of the Falls. You have a will in heaven. You can choose with your will in heaven. Just there's no evil. There's no evil to choose. Because once you're made, you're righteous by the blood of Christ, and once you die and you move to heaven, you can't ever fall. You can't ever sin. You won't ever, ever want to go away from him. So that part you don't have. There's no choosing good and evil in heaven, if that's what you're thinking about. But as far as having a will to choose, absolutely, you have a will to go wherever you want to or do whatever you want to in heaven. It's all going to be good.
Yeah, one of the things that I told people, and I know we're running out of time, but one of the things I try to tell people to help them, because it was something that the Lord placed upon my heart, is that when you are in love with someone, with all your heart, your mind, and your soul, it's very much like puppy love. So when you go back to when you were 12, 13, 14 years old,
yes,
and you fell in love with the first person, you
yes
wanted to do everything they wanted to do. You wanted
yeah
to
you
do everything
to
they
do
wanted
anything
to do.
And you didn't want to do anything to hurt them either,
right?
You never do
right
anything to hurt them.
Yeah, so it's like when you flow in the will of God in heaven, you love the Lord with all of your heart, your mind, and your soul. It is such an obsession that when the Father wants you to do something, you automatically want to be in his presence. You want to do it.
Oh, yes.
So, you know what I mean? So it's like the problem is our fallen state is so dark nowadays. We
it
just
is
have forgotten how
you
beautiful it is to have
your
that
flesh
oneness. Yeah.
You can't think beyond what your flesh itself experiences. But
yeah,
but spiritual love and spiritual life is so far above what we have here on the earth. The only good thing about now, of course, it's supposed to be on earth as it is in heaven, which means that we will choose life and love by our own will. Still living on this earth, we will choose the will of the Father. And then that's going to be an awesome way to live. But I know that one question that I forgot, one thing I forgot to mention way back when I was talking about creating a habitation for heaven in your home and not bringing all the stuff of the enemy into your home, because that will have an impact on your life, not just your life, but your family's life. One thing I can tell you absolutely that is one of Satan's symbols are skulls, because it represents death. His throne in the second heaven sits on a mountain of skulls. That is his, besides other symbols he has for his own, he loves that. He loves death. He comes to kill, steal, and destroy. He loves death. So I encourage people, do not have skulls in your home unless you're like a podiatrist or someone who has to have that for medical reasons. But I encourage people, don't have that, because that represents death. And I know on a lot of the apparel and the fashion wear now, the enemy has released new images for people to produce on clothing. And even in the women's section, they have a skull with flowers going in and out and around the skull and stuff to entice people, to entice, because usually women usually wouldn't wear anything like that. The men, of course, thought it was tough and mean and, you know, whatever. So they would wear those symbols on them to show, look, I'm tough. But that's not what that represents. So I encourage people, I wouldn't have it. I absolutely refuse to wear any of the clothing that has it on it. Because I think in this time, if you manifest, and manifest means that the way you live your life and what you believe is going to be demonstrated by what you're wearing, absolutely. I mean, people who play sports all the time like to wear athletic wear. People who are like do ballet and stuff like that, they're going to wear stuff that project that image. But if you're going to project life, and we need more life, and we need stuff that has a positive image, then I encourage people, choose, if you have a choice, choose something else. And especially don't give it to your children. Don't have your children start young wearing that image. And while we're at it, I'll throw Halloween in there just for free. I don't celebrate it. When I was young, I used to. I didn't understand what it meant. It's Satan's high day of the year. There's more satanic sacrifices done on that day than any other day of the year. And so I encourage you, and some people say you shouldn't go to fall festivals. I have no problem. Fall festivals celebrate life. This is the time of the year when harvests are brought in from the fields, and I know a lot of towns have fall festivals. Totally, you can enjoy that. It's actually almost a slap in the enemy's face when you celebrate something that represents life, when he calls that his day. So there's that for free. That's what I stand for. I'm always going to choose life and have images in my home. I even have beautiful things and happy things in my home, and there's nothing wrong in having fun, okay? Heaven has fun. They have more fun than we do. That's another awesome thing about heaven is you're going to go, you're going to run and do amazing, almost, it would be impossible on this earth, but God wants us because laughter is a medicine, and it does many things in you when you laugh. So please take time to laugh, okay?
Oh, I'm so glad you said that, because that's one of the things we get beat up for from other ministries. They're like, those guys are too jovial. They're joking around and happy. And I'm like, aren't we supposed to be happy? Praise Jesus.
Yes.
I think so. And you know what? We hardly have any time left, but just go ahead and take your time, because we do get some overtime from the radio system will allow us to keep going. So if you would share with people, this is a question from Jennifer and also other people, I'm sure. How can they partner with your ministry and contribute to your ministry? And then would you close with a prayer for us tonight?
Oh, I will definitely close with a prayer. And I actually had to create a special website. If you want to give online, you can go to katkerr.com. I try to remember. Most of the time, I'd say 90% of the time when I travel and speak, I don't mention my websites. I don't talk about my products even when I go to meetings and people are like, why don't you tell us about your products? Because my heart is to see people's lives change. My heart is to see people begin to engage with the Father in heaven and engage in life itself and stop just existing on the earth, exist to live like they do in heaven. And so if you want to give to me, now I am going to let you know that I'm not a nonprofit, because the Father wants us to make a profit for the kingdom. And I already can tell you this, that many ministries, this was man's choice to do this. It was not the Father. It was man's choice to make themselves nonprofit. heaven wants you to profit, because then it's money in the kingdom, okay? We need money in this earth to travel, to share the gospel of the kingdom, to become entrepreneurs. You know, there's going to be so many believer, Christian entrepreneurs putting millions into the gospel and into the kingdom. And I already know some churches that have changed to for-profit because they can have business on the sides, not in the sanctuary, but on the side, and take that money, put it in the church, put it in missions, and God's prospering them and flourishing them. I'm just going to encourage you to do it. This is a kingdom age thing. God wants to use a marketplace ministry. Be surprised how many people you can meet in the business world. And so I can't give you a tax deductible receipt, but we put you on our war wall, and we release the blessings of God for you to live kingdom life, for God to have a habitation in your home. We definitely pray blessings over you. So if you want to give online, you can do that, or you can just send a check in the mail, and you will receive. I send out thank you cards, and we're going to start a program. First time I've announced it on air. It's called the Guardian Zone, and we're gonna create a program where we do have people already giving to me monthly, and we're gonna start sending them probably like an e-newsletter or create newsletters, and also send them a gift, you know, like a CD or something, or some kind of I'm actually gonna take my books now and break them down into mini books on certain subjects, so I'll be sending them to people. I'm still working on like 50 projects at one time right now. But I think you can send something to P.O. Box. I can't remember what my own P.O. Box is anymore. I'm waiting for Jen to run in here and tell me what it is. But if you go to catcur.com, there's also a P.O. Box attached to the website. I have revealingheaven.com, where you go to order the products and see testimonies of people. And it's a whole brand-new website. We've redone the whole website. But if you want to give, you go to catcur.com, and there's free. So many videos on there, I can't tell you. You can set people there. They can be free from stuff. I share revelation about heaven. There's one called Zoe Living that shows you how to live a prosperous, successful, blessed life, how to be free from anything in your soul, learn to declare over your family. And so it's a spiritual platform for the Father to speak to his children. And I definitely appreciate it. I don't even get a salary. People don't know this. I don't get a salary from my company yet. I put all the money back into that so it can grow. We're about to get a facility. We're going to start creating products that represent heaven and put them in the marketplace. You're going to want doormats to say you're standing in the anointing. You're going to want powerful things that have messages from heaven on it. Home decor, things for your kids to play with, everything a teenager wants to wear. God's going to flood this marketplace with heaven to give them a choice besides the darkness and witchcraft.
Amen.
And so thank you. If you do give, we definitely have a way to record that, and we will speak blessings over you. You'll get a personal thank you card from me, and I just love people. I love you whether you give or not, but absolutely you're helping to send these messages and help me to create new CDs and DVDs. When you give, it's good ground. It's heaven's ground. So I thank you for that personally right now. And Father, right now I just speak your life. I release the life of God over everyone listening, Father. I release your purposes and your plans, God. Invade their life. Let them feel your presence over them. I speak the rest of the Lord over all those who haven't been able to sleep or who have a hard time sleeping. I release the rest of the Lord upon you, that you will have a full night's sleep. You'll be restored in the morning. Father, I declare that their souls will prosper because they're pursuing you. They're pursuing to operate in this kingdom age, to rule and reign with Christ. I thank you, Father, for giving them revelation, their self, drop it in their spirit. And I thank you that in all they're getting of wisdom, I thank you for giving them understanding, which is knowledge of the Holy One. So, Father, I thank you, and I bless this radio station. I bless them, Father. I bless them, and they're going in, and they're lying down, Father. I bless them in their finances. I bless them in their relationships. Father, I send the host of heaven to guard and protect them, Father. Anyone who's willing to give messages of life into this world and share messages of love of God, I release the host of heaven right now to pull down every stronghold that would come against this radio station, against any ministry that's teaching revelation and not just head knowledge, God. I send them forth right now. Father, I thank you that you've sent them here on our behalf. God, that it's not a weird thing or strange thing. In the Old Testament, your host went and fought physically on behalf of Israel. And they're all positioned now, Father. I thank you, God, for giving revelation to your children that they can prosper and flourish in the midst of everything going on. But they can also stop some of that stuff, God, if we take power over the power of the enemy, controlling the storms, controlling the terrorists, controlling any of the financial stuff that's going on, God, that's not you. Expose every wicked thing in any of the political arena. Expose all the enemy that would be trying to deceive people or hide them in this election year, God. Expose every bit of it, Father, so we'll know who is true and who really loves America, who wants to stand for righteousness, who wants life and power to come back to the land you call your own. I thank you, God, for blessing those who pursue you, because there's nothing greater, nothing more valuable, God, than knowing you and loving you. So I thank you for it, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
Praise Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Folks, more than ever before, be doers of the word, not just hearers of the word, deceiving yourself. James 1:22. Praise God. Get the word out. Get the word out. Time is short. We love it. Praise Jesus. It is now is the time to receive the outpouring of the Holy Spirit and to work and manifest in the power of the Holy Spirit on behalf of the people who are suffering across this world. Let's take back the kingdom of Jesus Christ. Let us let's get everybody we can and bring them to heaven with us. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. All right. Thank you so much for joining us tonight, Kat Kerr. I just love to have you on. God bless you.
Okay.
All right. Take care. Bye-bye.